back to him and then I'll go back to her.
Alright, ladies and gentlemen. The matches are gonna start in about, well, 10 minutes or so. So we'll just do a quick overview of the teams and such. Let's see. Let's get Spit in here. Where is Discord? There we go. Alright, boys. Spit.
Hello.
Hello, hello.
How's it going?
It's going good. I'm excited.
I'm a little bit nervous as well. You know, we have some pretty interesting games on hand tonight, Mystic.
Yeah, especially the second one, I would say. Second one is very exciting, I hope.
Yeah, so for those of you who haven't been following, we are streaming a tournament that determines the best of the War Thunder TSS tournaments. So that, for those of you who don't know what that is the automated tournaments run by War Thunder.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you compete for in-game prizes, you compete for ELO, basically, and, you know, you work yourself up. And this is the final for the 7v7s. Now, you know, to get here, you have to be pretty impressive. And, you know, most of these teams seem to demonstrate that quite well.
Yeah. And two of such teams are going to be, well, four actually. We got two games today. First game being OP against Verve, and the second game with Nasty against Madman. And yeah, OP is kind of a new team. It's pretty interesting. Got some it's a new team with all players basically.
Well, yeah, OP is basically old Think, old Dynamite, and Revy. Some guys from, you know, Revy and Eurus Squadron, mm-hmm. as well, which is the you know, the guys that often you see in your jet matches. Yeah. These guys are some of the most experienced people in the entire game when it comes to just general War Thunder. You know, players like Chippy have been around since the Alpha. Copsy, or Coppin, has been around since Thunder League as well. You know, he played for Team Think. Team Think placed fourth. You also have players like Panther, Villacy, Lubu, Sergey, who Sir was, I believe he was in GOF for Thunder League as well, and they placed.
Yes, I think so.
They placed fifth. So these players go back a long way. Mm-hmm. These guys have a lot of experience behind their hands. You know, as long as they can work together as a team. So recently we've seen them play against, I believe it was Enya Proxy. And yep. they were absolutely crashed because
yeah.
they're a bit rusty, a little bit mm-hmm. washed up.
And they didn't have all the vehicles spaded either. Because this tournament has kind of a newish lineup that you don't see often. So, yeah.
Yeah, well, not only that, but some of the vehicles are actually quite new. You know, there's an Italian mm-hmm. lineup and that includes the OF-40.
Yeah.
I don't know too many people who have unlocked the OF-40, you know, let alone spaded it.
Yeah, indeed. So yeah, that's OP. We got also Verve, which has been around since ever, basically. It says here with the information that we got that the team was created on March 1st, 2015. But they've been pretty much playing the game since the starting days. They've been Thunder League and tournaments before that in, you know, named... called TVG first before they changed it to Verve. So yeah
that's correct. So the Verve roster actually has a fair amount of very old players, and most of these come from either I believe some of them are from Dislike, or old Dislike. Some of them were from Verve, and it looks like a couple are from teams like Dynamite, and it looks like they've also picked up a couple of other, like, former Akai Victory and some other random players that have come along the way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a couple that come to mind are Yuki and 4CB. 4CB being the Russian YouTuber, in fact.
Yeah.
He covers tournaments himself. You know, go and check him out if you speak a bit of Russian or if you want to watch some tournaments. Very, very good players, all of these people. And they've been doing tournaments for a little while now. they're starting to work on their coordination, and it's getting really, really good. You can see by their ratings, much higher than the average. You know, they're getting to a stage where they're, you know, starting to take out tournaments a lot more consistently.
Mm-hmm. Although they did lose against Nasty yesterday, so.
Yeah, well, Nasty's at the top of the leaderboard, you know.
They're a scary team, that's for sure.
Yeah, these guys sort of came out of nowhere. I honestly, personally, I don't know any of these names, except for Boccia and Finnish Tiger, and Beg for Mercy, of course. But, you know, I don't know any other names, personally. I don't particularly recognize any of them, and to see them come out like this and just absolutely dominate is kind of surprising, but kind of interesting at the same time. They're a bit of a dark horse, let's say.
It's scary, scary dark horse.
Oh yeah, they've managed 100 kills in how many battles have they played? Two.
That's a lot. Well, the thing is, they played three matches each. Right. Well, played two matches, but three rounds each, because they lost one of their rounds in both of the matches. So, you know, with that, you can rack up a lot of kills, or you can die a lot as well.
That's true. Well, they do have the most deaths, but they also have the most kills.
Yeah.
They haven't got a bad kill death ratio per se as well. I think they actually have one of the highest. Maybe Madman can slightly edge them out there just with a little bit of quick maths, but. I think it's pretty close for the most part. Maybe the second highest kill death ratio, maybe the third highest. But at the end of the day, what matters is they've won both of their matches by quite a fair amount.
Yeah.
Even though they've gone all three rounds, it seems like, you know, they're doing the best overall. And at the end of the day, that's really what makes the winner.
Yeah. I did watch the first match, which we didn't stream, but we... I watched the first match Nasty did and see how they lost the match, which is, it's interesting because honestly, the match that they lost, they almost won back again. It was just down to time, basically, because at the end of the match, they regained pretty much the entire map again. So it just came down to time on that match and that round that they lost then.
Well, so, we'll have to have a look at how they go today. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping to see something pretty impressive, because they are up against the Madman, the one and only Madman.
Yeah, it's a strong...
These guys.
Scary team, which is also... Oh, my boy. They are speaking... You know, they're communicating in English. We should say that most of these teams are either... They're pretty much either Russian or English speaking, and most of them Russian, like Verve and... I don't know about Nasty, per se.
I'm not sure, actually, because I know Boccia is Russian, but I don't know who else is. Maybe if you're one of the players of Nasty in the chat, just you know, drop us a little bit of information. Do you guys communicate in Russian or in English? Because you know, most of these teams, like Mystic, you've said, communicate in Russian.
Mm-hmm. You have, like AV, like Verve.
Victory, Verve, and your proxy. I'd assume SQ.
That's a good question. SQ. Probably.
Yeah, and it's most likely Leet as well, and most of the other teams, actually. The only other one that potentially. Maybe GM1. I'm not sure. I doubt, but most of these teams are Russian because, let's face it, the Russians tend to take War Thunder the most seriously.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
tell me about it.
You can see most of the Thunder League teams even were from Russia, or, you know, like Verve from Belarus. But basically, you know, most of them were Russian. You know, I think it was like eight teams. There were only Think and Cube, and Cube was a...
American team, wasn't it?
Cube was American, but it was also a wing of Think. It was like a it was like Think's little
brother.
they put training wheels on Cube and said go.
Yeah.
And they came eighth. They didn't get very far, but you know, it was nice to see a second American team, or at least a second Western team.
I don't know. Was I think Dynamite, weren't they Polish?
Dynamite was Polish, actually. That's another non-Russian team. I mean, you can also count Verve as a non-Russian team, technically. But, you know, it's also a former Eastern Bloc country as well. So when we're talking, you know, either side of, I guess, the Iron Curtain, then,
The choosing the maps right now, OP is still not choosing, so waiting for them. But Verve already crossed out Poland, it seems, which is interesting. You know, on Poland, for example, you know, we haven't really seen any Italians being used. On Poland, you could make an argument for an Italian tank across the river, for example. Or, you know, on the other side, by the windmill, maybe?
The Italians with the Centauro, obviously, they have some, you know, some pretty good stock behind them. That thing is really, really quick, and it's slinging some heat FS.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you who don't know, let's just quickly run through the lineups. So essentially, it's around basically a sort of 6.7 to 7.7, roughly 8.0 lineup. You know, you have things like the M60s, the Magath, the T32, 82, the M163 VADs for the Americans. You know, the mainstays for the Germans are the 10.5 King Tiger, the M47, the M48. The Russians, the mainstays are the Object 906, the Yak-15, Su-2, IS-4, and the T-54s. For the British, you got mainly you've got the Conqueror, Vickers, Centurion, the Falcon, and then you have two Spitfires as well, which are your big boys, I suppose. Japan, Type 61, STAs, or STA-2, sorry, STB, Hori Production, Kika, and the first R2-Y2. This is one of the stronger lineups, actually. You have the STB and you have the R2-Y2.
The planes are very scary.
You know, the planes are crazy. You know, you have really good CAS, but once you sort of lose the planes, you've got your STB, which is fairly strong, and then you haven't really got much else.
No. Well, I would say, besides it's picking between the, not the object, the hard production and the Type 61, it really depends on the map, but I think I would rather be in the Hori production just because the gun and the armor is a lot more useful, I would say, than the Type 61 will be.
Of course.
That's just a personal opinion.
Just has a lot more going for it, honestly, if you... But we have a couple more lineups. So we also have the Italians with the 105 M47, the UF-40, the OF-40, the Orbel, the Centauro, and the R3 T20 with the anti-air cannon. G56 and SM-92 for planes, not a terribly strong pick. But I think we've saved the best till last. The French lineup is probably one of the stronger ones.
Yeah.
You have yourself a Lorraine 40T, AMX-30, AMX-13 SS-11, which, unless you're Leet, you're probably not going to use. So we saw Leet yesterday use the... AMX-13.
Plan was in the AMX-13 SS-11. He did get... He killed an M60, which is interesting. And he tried to... He almost killed an IS-4, but he died. So...
Yes. It's kind of questionable, but at the same time, you know, it was very, very interesting.
All right. I'll see... I want to see how OP is going to bounce back from... The kind of big fail against a proxy the first day, because, well, first of all, they didn't have anything spaded, well, not much spaded, I would say, and they weren't really, you know, they didn't really train much with the lineups, they didn't really, play much, per se, I should say, in terms of,
it was
of,
an
like,
absolute mess.
Yeah, it was a mess, basically.
It was an absolute mess, you know, obviously, I'm beating a dead horse with this particular example, but there was a point where Chippy was in his Falcon. Mm-hmm. He was fighting a Lorraine 40T. He was shooting him from the side. And, you know, Thunderpants in his STB, he drives out in front of the Lorraine 40T with the turret the wrong way. And, you know, he got subsequently taken out pretty quickly. You know... Are mistakes like these going to be corrected by OP, or is Verve going to just stomp over them again? Because we do have players like 4CB playing for the, you know, for Verve, and 4CB is particularly formidable. We've seen in the D-Day tournaments, especially 4CB absolutely pop off, and you know, Verve is extremely strong. So can they hold up? Yeah. We'll just have to wait to see.
And this, there's not really much room for mistakes in this tournament. I mean, you do have your team that can back you up, but you know, mistakes are mistakes, and they will cost you something in the end.
Of course, every little kill, every little death, every inch of ground means something in this match.
Yeah.
The way War Thunder works in terms of esports or in terms of competitive play is what you have to do is you start off at your spawn, obviously. Yeah. You work your way out to the cap. You assert your dominance over the cap. You take it.
Yeah.
you don't T-pose over it, though. You can't really do that in tanks, but what you do after that is you start to add defensive layers. You start to set up power positions. You start to set up flanking routes. You start to cut off essentially rotations, assault routes for the enemies.
Yep.
And eventually lock them down in their spawn.
Mm-hmm.
Once you get to that stage, you've pretty much won the battle if you have all the cap points and if you have all the tickets.
Yeah.
Most of the time, it doesn't always work out that way unless it's a complete stomp. The only times we've really seen that is, you know, we've seen a couple of matches on Normandy during the D-Day tournament. We saw a couple of lockouts from, you know, the previous match against OP, which was End Your Proxy versus OP. Hopefully, OP can, you know, bring that back. It'll be kind of interesting. I'm really curious to see how OP does here.
Yeah, it's the map is by the way, it's going to be Normandy, which is you know, it's an interesting map. I would love to see which team gets which side, because that will change the way they play. Because one end of the spectrum, or one team, I should say, has the C cap, which has quite a big elevation over, you know, over the entire map, basically. So, you know, the monument is a little bit more vulnerable to, you know, to go to, because you can get shot from C, and the spawn as well.
Yeah, well, you can lock down the spawn from that position, and that's really, really powerful. It's one of the spots that you can pretty readily utilize.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, whilst no one spawns on the beach, if you take the B cap, you have free reign on the beach. So, you know, again, it is a double-edged sword. But as we see, we're going to load into Normandy. We're going to have a look at what they, you know, what they pick for their lineups. Obviously, this is RB with markers. For those of you who don't know, you can spawn planes off the bat. You have three spawns dedicated to basically whatever you want. And, you know, the tactics from that become really, really diverse and interesting. You know, we've seen, what do we see here?
Okay, this is interesting.
Starting off with a very plain heavy lineup. 4CB in the R2-Y2, Poltergeist in the R2-Y2, and Destroy in a Falcon. Mm-hmm. The rest are going in British tanks.
Yeah, interesting. An interesting choice, because, you know, the British tanks are fully stabilized, but they don't have the best mobility. And their armor is, well, it works sometimes, but in other times it just doesn't do anything. You know, especially
the British
against
tanks are more centered around their gun.
Yeah.
Rather than their armor.
Mm-hmm. And think going with 2 Centurion Mark 10s, an MX50 Foch, which is going to be interesting against, you know, the L7 APDS.
Exactly.
So it's going to be interesting. And Ricky dies in the head-on. And Panther is also down. But Fosby and Poltergeist are also down, so nobody really won air there.
It's a bit of a loss situation. Yeah. It's back to the ground we go, and the fight will probably take place on the ground mostly.
I would love to see how Thunder Panzers are going to fight against Moonlight and Roughlex here, because he is going to meet some people in this road. And, you know, it's quite a scary tank. And there he goes. Thunder Panzers takes out Moonlight. Very nicely done. You know, Moonlight, for example, I think he can only really aim at the gun and then flank him, because I think it's completely fine against, like, L7 APDS from the front. You know, I'd be proven wrong if somebody tells me, but it's a chunky boy, the Foch, and it's a very good tank to lock down the road.
The only thing that can really stand up against the Foch is the Hesh shells, and it seems like Moonlight's actually gone and packed some Hesh, so maybe we can see some of that. Obviously, bombs will also do some damage, and that's exactly what has happened to Thundies.
Talking about damage, Koppen, very nice shooting with the Falcon here, which is probably one of the best AA at its battle rating in the game. It's such a beast.
Remember, ladies and gents, that Copsy is a renowned SPAA driver.
Yeah, he's mad.
In the Thunder League, Copsy said he literally spent months practicing in his Ostwind, and it seems like he's getting his mojo back.
Mm-hmm. So we see a pet, which is, I'll just say Ignacio. he's shooting into their spawn, which, you know, just shows you how powerful C can be. You can pretty much see the spawn from there, which is kind of insane.
Yeah, it's a very powerful position. You know, there's no real massive cover. You've basically got free reign on the spawn, and despite being in an STB, you know, everyone has pretty good armor here, so
yeah,
and pretty good and an even better gun, so you know, there's no really getting past Apet's gun. There's not a whole lot you can do unless you smoke it, exactly what Poltergeist is doing. Remember, we actually haven't seen smoke in like a widespread War Thunder tournament since ever. You know, nothing's been broadcasted to any War Thunder channel at all, you know, aside from a couple of small examples. But you guys are one of the first major groups of people, I suppose, to see smoke being utilized in tournaments and two-plane stabilizers.
I absolutely love what OP's doing now. They seem to have just, you know, gotten their tournament skills back, and they're taking some very strong early positions here. Like the Monument, like A point, basically, Thunder Panther is going to cap A with the Foch, and Panther is locking them down in the road, you know, against Roughlex. Those chevrons you can see that, you know, are on Roughlex, for example, those are artillery strikes, by the way. But Poltergeist seems to be backing up Roughlex, so we'll see how that goes against Panther.
If they can take out Panther on this flank, that means that they can get a pretty easy flank on the Foch. And remember, the Foch is a case tank destroyer, so it can't really turn a turret because it doesn't have one. And there goes Panther.
I bet takes out Moonlight in the spawn. So,
oh my god!
Now it's kind of scary for OP, because they can get shot from the side by Poltergeist and Roughlex here. Sir is looking in front, you know, understandably, and Lubu is on the Monument, although he did get hit just now.
And there's Amriki with the counterplay. Never mind. Sergei's with the counterplay, sitting there on the church, preventing the guys from Verve advancing. So they have to take out the guy on the church. This is really, really good play. I'm absolutely stoked to see this. You know, it's great. OP have stepped up their game.
Yeah, from that pretty big humiliation in the first round against any proxy, they seem to have gotten, you know, some of their skills back, it seems, which is lovely to see, especially against such a big team like Verve.
It's absolutely fantastic. It's almost like the so for those of you who don't know, the Thunder Cup was a thing in the before Thunder League. It was kind of like the pilot, and the finals had Think versus Verve. It's good to see a rematch, and it's good to see such a tight battle compared to you know, what else we may have seen.
Now, Roughlex can't really push here because Thunderpants is quite a scary tank. Isn't it quite a scary tank to push? Ooh, he shoots, but he misses.
But it's all good and well, but
can't pen him. Roughlex can't pen Thunderpants from the front with APS. You could try Hesh in the cupola, maybe, but it's such a difficult tag to pen.
He's got out 8 rounds. He's got 8 chances to make it happen.
Now, what Thunderpants can do here, he does have a cupola with a... Ooh, it gets set on fire, but he does have the 50 mil. He could he could have taken a destroy there with the 50 mil, but he did not, and now he goes down. So that means Verve can take the point. Wow, they retook that really, really well. It got onto the Monument.
They use that flank on the beach. Now they had the B point as their home cap, and they use that beachhead that no one spawns at, no one pays attention to. Works the same way as the C point, but it's not as effective. It's not as common. You know, most teams will use the C point and try and take control from there. But in this case, Verve have gone through the beach. Now you can't shoot the beach from the C point.
Yeah,
and this is something that's really, really intelligent because there's nothing that you can really shoot at from the C point.
Ricky, is there some trouble here? It goes down to Axie.
Again, we're looking at a very tank-heavy lineup. No cast whatsoever, aside from the first few spawns. And this is partially due to the Falcons just absolutely ripping to shreds any competition. Not only that, but the Falcon is perhaps one of the best AAs that are capable of tank destroying in the entire game. You can see what they did to the Fosh. Imagine what they'll do to a Vickers MBT.
Yeah. Ooh. It's not looking fantastic for OP now. They lost lots of their map control. So, love to see how they're going to take that back.
Panther's looking pretty sorry there. Yeah.
But Koppen is going to help him. And he takes out Force B with the Falcon. Showing how scary the Falcon can be with APDS belts. Koppen just destroyed two SDPs, which are it's just an amazing showing how good the Falcon is. It's such a
monster. Multi-purpose AA.
Yeah. It's more of a tank destroyer that can take out air targets as well, basically.
You do have to be careful, though, because Copsy has been taken out by artillery.
Oh. Yeah. It's not the most armored AA, that's for sure.
No. I mean, it's better than some. At least it's not open-topped, but it still has paper armor based off, I believe, the Bishop SPG, which,
I have no idea.
Not very fast.
You're probably not right. Very heavy. Yeah, it's not the quickest AA, that's for sure. A pet here is got his breach taken out. It's on one crew and has got his engine taken out, so he's kind of in trouble. Panther, the high production is good, but it's a pain to get it around corners because it's such a big target.
Yeah, it is very unwieldy. It's such a massive unit of a machine. Mm-hmm. It's really good for holding down a line, but,
Sir taking out Roughlex there.
And we're back in the air, it seems. 4CB versus Copsy. Copsy, well-renowned pilot, and 4CB, a well-renowned tournament player. Copsy put into work his 20 mils, but the kick is just a much faster.
Yeah, it's insane now. It got buffed a while back, and it's just crazy fast now. It doesn't turn very well, but it's the 30 mils is very scary, I think. It's the high velocity.
The kick is basically a 262 made by the Japanese, and,
With a big bomb.
With a big bomb, yeah.
Koppen, ooh. Those guns are very scary.
That's a Japanese 30. You don't want to get behind that.
Nope.
And that is exactly why.
And Koppen gets taken out. The Kika doesn't have a bomb anymore, though, so... It's not very useful besides killing, air targets.
Yeah, pretty much.
Ooh. Pets. Getting away from the 30s, smart Eddie. And he's coming in with the rockets on Evil. And takes out Evil. That was a beautiful shot in the Amarak.
Wow. What a fantastic play by Uppet.
Mm-hmm. And now OP's looking a lot better. Luba's going back to the monument, although Moonlight is here with his Conqueror Mark II, which is a scary tank. So we'll see how that goes. He's a super conqueror as well, so he has that extra addon armor, which is quite good against heat. I didn't like the conqueror before, before I got the extra armor. The conqueror is not my favorite tank, I should say.
Yeah, it's a very stressful tank to play. It's in a situation where you have multiple targets, it's quite difficult because it just doesn't have the reload to sort of deal with that stuff, and it doesn't have great gun depression either. I think it's only got 6 or 7. Degrees.
On this map,
Normandy,
gun depression is not very, very needed.
It doesn't really make much of a difference. No. Every little thing counts, and little things such as, Rolflex being tracked or critically damaged here by, Ignacio and the Mark 24. This could allow the guys from OP to actually take the A point back and reset the ticket bleed. We have 3 minutes left of the match, and as the game boils down to a close, we are going to have a much higher ticket bleed. It mm-hmm. gets progressively higher and higher as time goes by. Yeah. And the favor is going to turn back into, the game is going to turn back into OP's favor.
Yeah.
The problem is,
yeah,
I think we have Axie coming up to the monument. He's going to contest that position there.
That's scary with the Conqueror with that turret armor.
With Sergei, and then Evildoer. Oh my god, we're seeing a rush of Conquerors. Evildoer and mm-hmm. Moonlight coming in.
But Pet is still up, and he did kill... who did he kill just now? Force B. So they don't have air anymore. Sir is getting rushed. Now he does have a 4-second reload. He does take out Evil very nicely.
Through the smoke.
Yeah, beautiful. And now Moonlight. Ooh, that's scary. Non-pen. Ooh, and his breach gets taken out. But Coppin is pushing up, which means that he's going to get side shots onto Moonlight. So this is some very good communication right here. And there he goes. And he gets his... I think that's his gunner. I'm pretty sure that's his gunner. And Moonlight is going to go down here. By Coppin. Very nice flank.
Wow, this is absolutely amazing. Yeah. The ticket bleed goes back into OP's favor after Verve decaps.
Is it going to be enough, though? It's only 1 minute left.
We have a difference of 2,000 tickets. Now, if they can hold it for about the rest of the match, they are going to win.
Yeah.
You know, everyone's pretty much... This is really tense.
This is going to be very close.
Lubu 1 minute 20 on the clock. The Conqueror.
Yeah, the Conqueror is so scary. You can pen the breach, but it's a small breach.
If Destroy gets through, then it's very well possible that he could take back A. And whilst he's the only one left, it seems like, there is a bit of a roadblock. You can't really go into B and capture that.
And OP will win this, actually. Ticket advantage. So there you go. That was beautiful. I love seeing that match and seeing how well they communicate now compared to what they did against Aeo Proxy. That was something else.
There's a slight shift in tactics here. You've seen a lot more British. You've seen a lot less, specialized lineups. You see a lot more all-rounded lineups, and it turns out that it's probably going to be for the better.
Yeah.
You look at these absolute monsters.
Mm-hmm. That was beautiful. I love seeing the pushback from that last... it was pretty humiliating, honestly. That was not a pleasant match to watch for them.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It was... I had my hand in my head. my head in my hands. Just... It was miserable, but it's so good to see that OP have finally turned themselves around.
Yeah.
It looks like they've got themselves together. Mm-hmm. I'm really, really hopeful for OP now after seeing them in this match. It's absolutely incredible what we're seeing here today.
Mm-hmm. Well, they also got some time to, spate more of their vehicles and, play a bit more. Yeah, I don't know if they practiced any, to be honest. I wouldn't be surprised if they did, or just talk more about it, right? Talked about more tactics and stuff like that.
Just having a run through your tactics is really important as well. Mm-hmm. If you don't come into a match with a tactic and with a sort of idea that you want to do, it tends to,
it doesn't go well against these other great teams.
Yeah, you can't really just sort of freelance into the match and expect it to go well when everyone else has got some sort of specifically organized tactic, and it just doesn't work that way.
Yeah, they got their lineups also fixed out, it seems. They got a lot more purpose, purposeful tanks, I suppose. With, the Foch, I loved seeing the Foch, pretty much block an entire road from pushing at the start of the match.
And that's exactly what it's used for. It is a giant roadblock, 300 millimeters of armor on the front, maybe, what is it? It's almost 400 effectiveness.
Yeah, it's insane.
That thing is an absolute monster holding down a road, and that is exactly what they used it for. Beautiful use of their tanks, great knowledge of the map, great knowledge of their vehicles, and honestly, excellent coordination as well. It's fantastic to see.
Mm-hmm. But how will they fare on the other side of the map now?
We'll see. It's a matter of time before we figure out exactly why, because on that C cap, you have an elevated position, and one thing that elevated positions do in War Thunder is give you a bit more view, give me a bit more perspective on the map, and allow you to set up some angles that maybe you wouldn't have found otherwise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Kind of takes me back to a Whip Energy video where he finds a couple of ridiculously boosted spots on Finland.
Whip, you know? he just finds the weirdest stuff in game. Like, I don't think he plays much War Thunder now, but when he used to, he would just talk to me and he would just say, I found another broken spot. Or he'd just show me something else that is just totally nuts. Like he made that video on the bombing with torpedoes, which was, that was hilarious. Yes. That got fixed very, very quickly.
I mean, so, that's pretty broken.
Yeah.
But, you know, Whip, you know, having seen plenty of his videos and having chatted to him, he just seems to be, you know, one of those guys that just loves to find all the weird things and exploit them until they get fixed.
You can't blame him, can you?
Oh, it's hilarious.
It's though, in the game. You know, it's a feature, comrade.
Yeah. But yeah, it's absolutely fantastic to see the work that OP has put into this. It's so good, you know. Verve, however, you know, they perform pretty well. Chances are they were just put on the side that they weren't as comfortable with.
Yeah, that's one thing about
We are going to switch over to this side, and, you know, maybe they will make use of the C point. Apet did get himself a kill.
Yeah.
On that, into the spawn, and there are certain exploitable positions in this map that, you know, maybe the Verve guys will be able to put to greater use. I'm kind of interested to see, because obviously, you know, Destroy, Moonlight, 4CB, these guys are very, very experienced players and they know what they're doing most of the time. Mm-hmm. It's just maybe in this case, OP has just hit them back with something they're not used to, or maybe it's a matter of Verve just being on the wrong side of the map and, you know, not being on their comfortable side.
Yeah. Maybe it's just time for some new players on the block instead of Verve, because Verve also lost the D-Day tournament to Madman. And now they lost one match against Nasty. So maybe it's just it's time. It's finally time for someone new to be on the number one position, or two or three for that matter.
Yeah, that's certainly not a bad thing. I love seeing a constantly changing and constantly evolving esports scene, because mm-hmm. the more people that take out that top position every season, every different, you know, guy that comes first, it means that the person who lost their, you know, their title has got some work to do and got some improvement to do, and you constantly see a level of improvement, and hopefully that's what we're going to get out of the Verve guys as we load into the second map.
See a little bit of a different lineup with OP here. They went for a Conqueror, and instead of the what is it called,
the Fosh,
they take a Lorraine.
Yeah, we've got Thundies here with the Lorraine 40T.
Mm-hmm.
Lorraine 40T being extremely fast, but it doesn't have a stabilizer, and that gun is really, really, whilst being extremely powerful, it's not a terribly stable gun. It tends to bounce around a lot, and unless you're, you know, in a hull down position, I guess the idea is to get to the cap first and see if you can take that.
But... And Ricky gets taken out. Force B also gets taken out, so it's Panther, which is one engine left against, well, not anymore. You got taken out by Destroy. But Coppin also takes out the R2Y2. So that means there's, it again, no one won air. And, you know,
again,
the Falcons is just cleaning up.
Panther season. But at the same time, Poltergeist managed to get off his bomb onto Lubu.
Yeah.
This will eventually spiral up into an advantage. It's only an advantage by one vehicle kill so far, but you know, if Verve can really capitalize on this, they can take out the OP guys, and you know, it could result in some devastating effects.
Yeah, Royal's taking C, Thunderpants is actually taking A, and he's now in a just a defensive position. He's getting spammed by Arty, so. It's kind of rolling the dice if you live through that or not.
He doesn't have anything damaged, but I think that play was really important. Thunderpants in the Foch last match, holding down the town square, and now in this match, he's getting there early before anyone else can really set up.
Yeah.
I think this is the meta for this side. You know, you don't, it's, you've got an asymmetrical map. You don't play it the same way on each side, and I think this is a really, really good adaptation by Thunderpants and OP in general.
Thunderpants pretty much denying Roughleg the push, because otherwise he'll just take a shot. Destroy is going pretty wild on the beach here, which is going to be interesting, because maybe Sir doesn't see that coming, although I think he actually might.
Yeah, Verve doing that dank flank. Amriki looks like he's spotted him.
Sir does see him. No? Oh, no. So this might be bad for... Oh, no, Sir's he. Oh, he sees him. Yeah, he just shot.
There we go. That gives away his position, but do remember it also distracts him and uses up a shell. So, you know, Destroy can probably just chill, sit tight here, wait for another plane.
Although, Coppin...
And try and get some shots off.
Coppin is in a position, so, you know, Destroy and his Falcon can't really push through the beach anymore. And Amriki and Sir... in a tricky situation here, because they you know, they got Axe in the monument and they got Moonlight here on, you know, looking at the beach.
Yeah, obviously Axie and that Centurion Mark 10 all bushed up. There's not a really clear shot on him unless you have Heat FS or, you know, a good APDS shot.
Yeah. Thunderpants is still locking down the A point, which is interesting. He's still getting spammed by artillery.
This Roughleg's... is a really clever move as well. They're already bleeding 3,000 tickets off them. This could end pretty quickly if Verve doesn't do something about Thundies.
Roughleg seeing if he can get a shot onto Sir. So that's interesting.
And... Axie taking out Panther.
Oh, that's not good for them.
Not looking good. Remember that Monument is a really powerful power position from Verve. And if Verve can exploit this... then they can pretty much deny the entire town square. They can deny reinforcements. And if you can kill Thunderpants, then you pretty much have the town square. And it seems like that is exactly the plan. Roughleg is going with the flank around to try and engage Thunderpants. And
yeah. The only real, like, guy they have to worry about right now to flank is both a pet Lubu and Sir. Because if those guys go down, the Thunderpants is in a bad position.
And Ricky, he's sort of up the creek without a paddle, you know.
Yeah. And Ricky...
And Sergei's down to two crew.
Trying to flank. I have no idea what that shot was. I think he's loading... Yeah, he's loading the APDS. Very smart idea, because those... those... about wire can eat an entire heat shell. And he does take out the general loader by... on Moonlight. Destroy did get taken out his Falcon, so he's going to come back with the Centurion Mark 10 to maybe stop Amriki from flanking. Axie gets taken out by Panther and his Kika. So
absolute genius play there. That was perfect.
That was a good bomb.
That'll allow them to secure the town square a lot more. And, you know, what they can do now is they're starting to add those layers of defense onto the cap circles. Something that Verve is starting to sort of struggle with getting the hang of.
I don't know. They got C point, but you know, Royal isn't really being much of use right now, right? He's in a position where he can't really do anything for his team.
Yeah, it looks like he's trying to kill Copsy, but, you know, nothing's really coming of it. I think he needs to, you know, come a little bit closer into the battlefield, try for that flank onto maybe Lubu or, Ignacio, you know. It's not really doing anything. Maybe he needs to come in closer. Maybe, you know, he needs to start supporting his team a little bit more. But, you know, look at the tickets. And look at the timer. Yeah. We're only halfway through and the tickets are almost halfway gone. You know, I think by the 10-minute mark, if they keep this up, they're going to be at a 2-0 victory.
Yeah. That would be insane. That's pretty massive. That's only quick.
That's a massive turnaround from the other day. And Moonlight taken out again by Amriki in the STB1. Actually, that's a fantastic shot. That was from just below the monument.
Yeah.
In the little beachhead there.
Now, Destroy's facing up against Amriki here. You know, Destroy it has a stabilized gun and stuff, but Enrique got a lot more troll armor, I would say. He has such an angled turret. And it's an STB, so he also has a stabilizer and has heat. So it is a scary tank to face, honestly.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible what these tanks can sort of pull off. But the only issue is the Centurion has some pretty trolly armor. And Ricky popping the smoke there to sort of take cover and repair.
Blocking no, he doesn't need to repair. He just has to reload, because the reload on this thing takes so long. Actually, that's the only bad thing about the STBs.
He's
like an 8-second reload.
Not damaged, but he's got two crew members that are either dead or, you know, damaged.
Oh, now he takes out Destroy's gun breach, so he has to repair now. Now
that's pretty bad.
Axie might be able to help him here, but if he does, I'm pretty sure Sir's just gonna push up and shoot him in the turret. So
yeah,
I think Destroy's
exactly
going down here.
If you have a 2v2, turning it into two separate 1v1s is the easiest way. If you have a slight advantage over one, it's a really, really solid way to get that advantage and continue it.
Moonlight did take out Enrique's loader, and I think Enrique's going down. There you go. Enrique getting denied the flank on Axie. But, I mean, they haven't flanked yet, so... Verb hasn't really pushed yet, so they don't even need to flank them. Because if they just lock them down right now, because the thing is, Alubu and Coppen have the SCB 1 down, Force B can't really poke out because Thunderpants and Lorraine. Sir is also locking down Axie, which actually Axie gets taken out by Lubu.
By the artillery again.
So yeah. Oh, now it's not looking that good for them.
Yeah, it looks like Thunderpants has managed to just sit there and chill, but also deny the entire map for Verve. And this is really working in their favor.
Mm-hmm.
This is such a powerful position. And because he managed to get there early before anyone else with the Lorraine 40T, it's looking so strong.
Yeah. Moonlight is trying to get Sir, or just, you know, flank around to kill Thunderpants at least. Roughlex is now coming in, seeing if he can get Thunderpants from the point. But the thing is, Thunderpants is such a quick reload, and it's such a ton of a ton of penetration and pretty much post pen effect as well, that it's very difficult to engage that. Poltergeist.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, Thunderpants is going down, so they're gonna take the 8 point.
That's a really nice takeout, and whilst they don't have many tickets left, the timer is now at 10 minutes, almost 10 minutes. And, you know, unless they can keep these caps for a long time, then Verve is looking in a little bit of a dire situation here. They're down spawns, they're down tickets, they're down everything except caps at the moment. Maybe you could argue that they're starting to get their map control back because they've forced so many people back to their spawn.
But the thing is, now they're coming in with bombs now. And that is scary because Verve doesn't have any AA up yet. And Force B, you know, doesn't have spawns left, so they either need to J out and get bombs, or they're just going to get free bombs on. But with the means
some
of
them can't even afford to do that because they'll be on their last spawn otherwise. And
yeah, true.
This is something that the OP guys can really take advantage of.
It's 4 minutes left, and they got quite a lot of tickets to go, although the ticket counter is going quite fast. Now,
have a look at...
What?
Wow. Lubu just ammo racking STB there and tracking Roflex at the same time.
Ooh, that's very scary because Coppin with his Falcon. Yeah, I saw that coming. Thunderpants is probably going to bomb Destroy now, and maybe Axie gets taken out by Lubu as well. Wow, what a retake.
What a fantastic retake.
Destroy
this
is going to get bombed now. Ooh, he missed actually. Thunderpants missed with his bomb. But he's the only one really stopping them from pushing now. Lubu and Coppin can take the point. Ooh, Lubu has to watch out. Lubu takes out Destroy.
Remember very what nice I was saying about retake. That gun depression? Going over those trenches is going to raise your gun just that little bit and give Lubu the edge.
Yeah. I mean, also, the thing is that the Conqueror, it has the ammo rack pretty much anywhere in the tank.
In the front, at the, you know, on the sides, you know,
it's just a ammo rack, basically, on tracks. So Lubu is going to take that back the point, and Ricky is going to lock down the monument. Which, you know, what are you going to do in a Falcon against Ori production? Pretty much nothing.
Barrel if you're lucky, but yeah. Now they're starting to really get the hurt on. And unless the OP guys somehow mysteriously all disconnect because of Thunderpants' Australian internet, then I think we've got ourselves a nice clean victory for OP.
Yeah, that was a beautiful retake just now, showing how, you know, how well just bombing a few guys works when there's no AA up. And at that time, you really need to make decisions. It doesn't help that Lubu and Carbon just cleaned them up, basically.
Yeah, Lubu with the, you know, doing an absolutely crazy job. He's on 4 kills, 4 assists, yeah. 1 cap and 1 death.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have ourselves an MVP here, and it's Lubu. Yeah.
That was wild. And Ricky did very well as well. Yeah, he did a lot of work on the beach as well, I should say.
Yeah, well, Amriki, whilst he didn't get many kills, I mean, 3 kills for 2 deaths is still, like, not bad.
Mm-hmm.
But having done so much positional work and so much sort of locking down, you know, puts Amriki as a really good supporting role. You know, he did a fantastic job in this role, and it's really showing.
Yeah, that was that's interesting to see. I didn't think they would do so well. Now, after the pretty big loss against Aya Proxy. They're doing very well now in terms of
this is such a massive
communicating.
I'm absolutely thrilled to see this improvement. And one of the things that you see is, you know, someone gets knocked down, the quicker they get back up is the more impressed it leaves me.
Yeah, indeed.
I'm completely dumbfounded at how well they've done.
Mm-hmm. That was beautiful playing from them. I didn't expect them to improve that quickly, to be honest.
I mean, maybe they just got to shake off the dirt and polish up the steel, and they're ready to go again.
Mm-hmm.
This is the potential that I've been wanting from OP, and it's really coming through. This is where it should be at for them, and they've shown us that they're more than capable, and they've still got that touch that they've had since Thunder League Season 1.
Yeah. That was a beautiful match to watch. You know, Verve being created in 2015. Yeah, they were doing well for a while, but now
they got a bit of competition.
Yeah, they got competition. That's for sure.
Even if that's just not, even if that's not necessarily a Western team. You know, they have Enya Proxy as well to worry about. They also have the AV guys. It's, you know, starting to really heat up in the War Thunder esports scene. You've got plenty of really good talent that's starting to come through, and it's really, really good to see. Absolutely amazing.
Copsy is saying in chat that there were 3 people before they started. Like 50 minutes before they started, there was only 3 people up. So they scrambled their place together quickly, which worked well.
It's really impressive. They managed to pull themselves together so quickly.
Yeah, and that's beautiful. So yeah,
really, really impressive.
I think I will ask Zerba if he's ready for the giveaway, which will be a question.
So we have a couple of goodies to give away. We have, how many do we have for this particular match?
I think it's 5, like 5 prizes of 150G and some boosters.
You can't really go wrong with G and boosters. It's, even if it's 750, you know, that's a tier 4 modification or a tier 3 modification. Or, you know, the rest of those parts in FPE that you've been dying to get your hands on for your M1 Abrams, because Sean wouldn't give them to you for free, you know.
I love that.
God love Sean. Only a joke, of course, but you know, it's good to have a laugh.
Got to keep the meme alive.
Of course, it's nothing quite like a good joke. But anyway, jokes aside, if you know the answer to this question, type it out in chat, and that will make you eligible for a giveaway. Once we roll the dice, a couple of you will be chosen, and after the stream, Zerba will contact you, or after the match.
After the giveaway, pretty much.
Well, yeah, well, we're at the end of our match. So I think, as soon as possible, as soon as Zerba can, because he is a busy man. Zerba Claw is too busy giving out all those gifts and running the whole esports scene. You know, it's the silent workhorse. But Zobar is going to contact the winners after. And so, you know, just be a little bit patient and send him a nice thank you and, you know, tell him how much you love him. He's a good guy.
Let me get one thing ready. Got to get it right, because if I ask the wrong question, then that would be kind of lame. So yeah, the question is, what year was Verve founded? And if you know the answer on that, put it in the chat, and we'll have 5 winners to be, you know, 5 winners to pick from. It will be random from the people that we've got the year right, of course. And if you have answered and you're very, you know, you're very sure about it, you don't need to answer twice or more, because it doesn't do anything, basically.
Well, I just put my answer into the chat, and it's given me a little prompt from Moobot. So, you know, if it gives you that prompt, I wouldn't worry too much. You're in.
Yeah. Only 5 winners, though, so, you know.
Yeah.
But still.
Oh, if I get my code, I'm giving it to anyone but Upet.
I see. Orange Doom. he's coming in for that free GE. Yeah, download description below.
He's going to put it on the Green Doom and ruin the account.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's not spending money, so he's technically right, I suppose.
Yeah, that's very true, you know. It could be kind of like, you know, Quickie Baby doing a similar thing.
Yeah.
He's gone and gotten the Twitch Prime, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
How long should we keep this going at this this giveaway? Maybe close in like a few minutes?
I guess when the wonderful Zerba Claws tells us. You know, we don't want to give away too much stuff. We don't want to lower everyone's chances. So, you know, we could just split it all, and we could give everyone, you know, there's 171 people in the stream. We could, you know, give everyone about 0.65 GE each.
Yeah. <How'd that> work? Flexing with that GE. I've got 0 right now. I should participate as well, I suppose.
Yeah, I've had myself a nice 117, quite like a certain character from a certain video game that is gonna come to Steam soon. You know, if you know what I'm talking about.
Ooh.
Who's that? It's it might be the Master Chief, you know.
Oh.
Spartan 117.
Poggers,
dude. You don't know your lore enough, man. I'm disappointed. But, yeah, we're looking pretty good here. 170 people watching. Thank you all for watching, by the way. It's pretty incredible. Let us know, you know, what you're thinking. It's good to have some feedback. Obviously, you know, if you want to follow us, if you want to, you know, if you want more of Mystic's beautiful voice and his absolutely wonderful gameplay, you can always follow him. You know, Mystic's a mod here. You just click on his name and click follow, or you know, something like that. You don't have to do that for me, though, because I have enough. Nah, I'm kidding. For me, it's
go to Spit's YouTube channel. Yes.
Yeah, bro.
He also streams, but not that often. Right.
Oh, my streams are top quality, man. Absolutely. Yeah. You know, maybe I'll do a cooking stream. It's still better than Oranges.
Poggers, dude.
Still better than Oranges, that's for sure. And you know. Good times, guys. Good times. We're looking at some some pretty good stuff here.
Yeah. All right. Well, the match is gonna it's gonna start in 12 minutes. But when will I think if the what is it? The poll not the poll read. The giveaway closes, we'll, you know, do like a 5-minute. You know, just a simple song in between, so we can take a little bit of a break, and yeah. And so you guys can enjoy a beautiful song, I suppose. Spitz is gone for a sec. So let's see what comes out of this giveaway. So yeah, that was beautifully played, and I like the tactics both teams used, especially OP with the Foch, and you know, in the first round locking down a road, but then being so different on the second match and going directly for the cap with the Lorraine. That was very interesting and fun to watch, to, you know, not see the same tactic used every round, right? And I would say a pet was a lot more useful than Royal was in on the C point in terms of like shooting into that spawn. And I also think OP used their planes a lot more effectively, you know, and you know, using their Falcon a lot more effectively, you know, with Cop and just absolutely destroying everyone with the Falcon. You know, he's good in the Ostwind, but if you give him a Falcon, that thing is monstrous. So much penetration.
Cops is a different monster in the Falcon. It's incredible to see. Yeah.
It's you know, so much penetration, so much velocity as well. It's such a scary AA.
Yeah, and especially having an APDS belt, one of the few SPAA at that battle rating that penetrates, what was that, 110 millimeters with the APDS?
Yeah, around that.
You know, it's pretty impressive. It's like a pretty decent little SPAA, and it's probably the best at 7.7 yeah. Or at rank 5.
Oh, there's nothing else at 7.7.
I mean, you have the SIDAM or the, you know.
Well, I mean, that's, yeah, it's no.
You know. That's also pretty interesting, you know. Let's not talk about the Duster.
Duster is sad. Yeah. Sad. Yeah. Well, it's. I mean, don't get me wrong. The 40 mils are good, but then again, you have the M19, like 1.7 battle rating lower, which does pretty much, you know, the same thing.
It does the same job, and it arguably has a. It's got a lower profile. It's also based on the M24
yeah.
Chaffee.
I like the reverse gear more as well on it. And you know, not having the turret in the middle has its advantages, like poking out, you know, behind people.
Yeah.
So yeah, it seems like the giveaway has closed. So yeah, that's nice. The winners are
Keeve,
Die for Toast, Rutek, Augustin, and Pershing DE. So yeah, nice. rigged. For surely.
Yeah, it's pretty rigged.
You know? I didn't get my prize. What the hell, man?
Yeah, I didn't win, man. What's going on? I gotta contact Zerba and see if I can get some.
Come on, bro.
Some cheek. Give me my cheeky G.
Yeah. Give me my cheeky, bro. So yeah, congrats to everybody that won this first one. There'll be a second giveaway after the second match, which will be Nasty against Madman. That's going to be an interesting match because, you know, I've not seen Nasty play yet, so I'll be very excited to see, you know, what they have in store. They've shown their skills, you know, in the previous matches, which we didn't see.
Yeah, well, Madman, I'm probably their biggest fan, you know.
I mean, we've seen Madman play for a while now in the D-Day tournaments in against, was it AV yesterday? I think so,
it
right?
Was.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was, yeah.
Well, we have the tournament brackets.
Yeah, it is. So yeah, you know, they have been showing, you know, their skills very well. And, you know, I'm excited to see them play again. But Nasty, it's just, I just don't know them that well. So it's so difficult to know what they're going to do. It's actually scary.
Well, you know, I know Botcher and I know Finish and Beg for Mercy, and that's literally it. I really can't wait to see these guys make a name for themselves because, you know, people like from Mad Men, for example, African Hut has made an absolutely crazy name for himself. He's one of those players that just manages to find the spot and absolutely make the enemy pay for it. And it is so interesting just watching him pop off. You know, he spawns in a Conqueror on Kuban yesterday and just casually shoots down an R2-Y2 with his main gun straight off the bat.
Yeah, that was
10
wild.
10 meters outside of spawn.
Man, you just surprised us with that. I didn't even, you know, he's just, he surprises us too much. I keep forgetting to switch to him and see what he's going to do.
It's So whenever Madman plays it, it basically becomes the African Hutt show. And,
basically.
He's such an incredible player, and you know, Nasty being on top of the team, on top of the leaderboards with their two victories, but taking it all the way out to the third map every single time without fail. Are we going to see three maps from Nasty? Because you know they managed to win all three maps, but do they manage to take a point away from Madmen? You know, Madmen have managed to close out all of their matches 2-0, 2-0, 2-0, and that's probably why they're on bottom of the leaderboard.
But the thing is though, what Nasty did is they lost one match, but they end up, you know, on top because they got so many kills by doing that. It's incredible.
Well, yeah, that's exactly why with a Swiss bracket tournament, you know, you have these situations.
Let's see
how Madman goes. Literally every match counts. So you know, I guess maybe Nasty have just game the system. They're dragging out the matches to see who they can, they can beat. But
that'd be interesting.
If Madman can beat them, you know, 2-0, maybe that'll put a spanner in the works.
Yeah. And let's see how the bracket looks actually, because we should look at that. Oh, it's interesting. Oh, very interesting. Okay. So, do you have the bracket in front of you, Spit?
Yeah.
Okay, let me update mine on...
I came prepared today.
let me get it fixed real quick. But you get it up already, and...
Yeah.
Let's talk about it real quick.
Remember, we've only had, I believe... How many matches have played out today? It looks like... We have all but one, so GM versus GGEs has yet to come out with a second round. The second round hasn't finished yet. And of course, Nasty and Madman are yet to play. So Madman sitting at seventh is probably the reason, that's probably the reason why. It's really interesting to see Aves, though, at second place, followed by Nasty, and then OP at third, Enya Proxy at fourth, SQ at 5th, Lead at 6th, Madman at 7th, obviously haven't played the game yet. And all the way at 8th, we have Verve, despite them having 107 ground targets destroyed.
Damn.
Playing 3 matches and only winning 1.
So yeah, I got the bracket up now on stream. Perfect. Alright, let's look at it. Let's look at who won and who didn't. So, OP won against Verve, which we just saw happening. Elite won against ABLOL. ABLOL not looking so hot. Not gonna lie, they haven't been doing so well. So that's kind of sad for them.
Them and GGEs haven't got a single victory yet.
Although the thing is, with ABLOL is that Venator is, you know, he said that he pretty much scrambled their team together in like last second to just get at least 10 teams into the tournament. So that's the. Yeah, that's why. That's probably why they are not bottom, because it's just a scrambled mess. So
at least they get a couple of nice camouflages at the end for composition.
Well,
actually
no, because only
no
to 10 till 10th place get the camouflage.
Oh boy.
So yeah, Enya Proxy lost against AV. That's very interesting, because Madman yesterday won against AV.
Yeah,
so
and,
that is going to be scary.
Enya Proxy has proven to be a pretty solid team, but losing 2-0 against AV, I'm told there is a little bit of tension between AV. It was either AV or Enya Proxy and Verve. I can't remember which one, but between the Russians, there's a bit of competitiveness, and seeing AV come out on top after being a bit of a sleeper for a little bit.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
It's really peculiar, you know.
So let's see. Okay, GM1 still haven't finished the match, but GG Easy is a very strong team as well. It's interesting that they lost the match against GM1. You know.
What's more interesting is that they're in dead last.
Oh yeah, you're right. GG Easy is dead last. Wait, what did they do yesterday? Okay, they lost against YRA, and they lost against AV, I see. Yeah.
Okay. So we have six rounds, and tonight is the beginning of round three. Is it round four for some reason?
What?
I'm a little bit unsure. You know, you look at the round four bracket, it's only got one matchup.
No, that's look at the time. That's just round three, but it's later.
Okay, so it's round three, part two. There we go.
Yeah, basically.
Problem solved.
So we can stream it, that's why.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's going to happen. And SQ winning from YRA, which is interesting.
Yeah, well, YRA, you know, again, I can't tell you who these people are. Lollipard, I know of. He is a Polish guy, and he used to play... he used to be pretty decent in Sim. He also, I believe, used to play with Smeagol-Tarn, if I'm not mistaken. Or one of the... You know, one of the Polish guys who were sort of up there, either YouTube or tournaments. I can't remember which one. But apart from that, I personally don't recognize any of the names. That kind of, you know, that's fine. That's fine that I don't recognize them. Maybe they should start to make a name for themselves.
Yeah.
It'd be really, really good, you know. And of course, all of these tournaments are available on the TSS website. Yeah. So.
By the way, the map picking is on right now, Spit. So.
Oh, let's hop into that. That's
yeah. Okay then. Okay, the map picking thing is a bit broken, for me.
Yes.
It doesn't move with the the browser. Okay, that's interesting. Whatever. So Normandy gets banned, and Eastern Europe, which is interesting.
Normandy, one of the interesting maps, and Eastern Europe. For me, you know.
Oh,
I'd be inclined to pick that every single time without fail, but obviously not.
I like Madman's choosing. It's always different, you know. With these other teams, it's mostly down to either Poland, Normandy, or Advance of the Rhine, for example. But it seems like Madman is, you know, going pretty wild. They're banning two quite popular maps.
Not only that, they're leaving Middle East on the board, which is, yes, in my opinion, the worst map out of the entire roster.
Yeah, true. I would agree with that.
If Madmen doesn't ban out Sinai or Poland, then if Nasty doesn't ban out Middle East, then it's going to be the pick.
Mm-hmm.
Middle East is probably one of the maps with the most exploitable positions, so maybe the African Hut Show will be absolutely thrilling with Middle East, because you have that many exploitable positions. The only thing is, it's not that great. Otherwise, no, you basically have city fights. And
it is. There's so many angles to watch on Middle East. It's crazy, right? It's the same with Italy, in my opinion, where it's just has so many angles that you need to worry about, especially in tournaments where you can basically pop out anywhere. It's just, it's very, very difficult.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And we have either Middle East or Sinai.
Middle East?
Oh my god.
I didn't see that coming. Okay. Middle East.
Wow.
Interesting. You know, I have no clue why. I'm a bit flabbergasted right now. I have no clue what to say.
Yeah, it's just why. I don't understand why you picked that map. It's just not a... not a really good choice for maps. It's maybe it is meant to be the African Hut Show, and that's exactly what we're going to have a look at. I think the Middle East is a, you know, decent map for CAS. You know, you have the mountains to take cover on one side. Maybe you can make use of that, but you know, there's not a whole heap of different things you can do. There's plenty of spots to sort of not quite camp, but to snipe. You have the what's it called, the ridges off the spawn. You also have that little area north of the sea point where you have a pretty decent opportunity to flank.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
some I've not really seen it in a tournament being played. I've played it once in tournaments. That was a very long time ago, and that was, you know, before the map and thing, you know, was a thing. So that was just, you know, rolling the dice on what map you get. So now it's, you know, down to players, which is interesting that they chose this map to me.
Yeah, well, now I think it's down to your individual tank skill. And, you know, Mad Men being more of a sort of ground-focused squadron, of a ground-focused team, it's going to be interesting because these are mostly flat surfaces. Are they going to be taking the British and using those APDS shells? Or are they going to, you know, run a Lorraine 40T to run around on those city maps? Yeah. Are they going to take a Chintaro? Are we going to see the good old Centaur from
that
the
could be
Italian?
Actually very interesting, because there's some positions that you need to be, you know, you need a really fast tank to go to. There's that ridge line at A that like one team gets, which actually there's two very good positions at A which you can get to if you got a quick tank, right? There's maybe I can get a map for the stream. Let me get it. Middle East. So I can explain it more. Let's see. Because I would love to show you guys what I mean. Let's pick this. Open image, a new tab. And that should be fine. Can you tell me when the thing starts so I can switch my stuff over?
Yeah, no worries, no worries.
Because am I ready up? Oh, let's ready up first before that happens. All right, Rikuchi now. Let's show what I mean. So you got an area at A, right here at H6, which is a very interesting spot because if you get hero soon with the Centauro, which you need to go quick because otherwise you can get shot from, from the people pushing up to A. So you got to get there real quick, but you can because there's a road here which you can drive along. It's a very strong position because you're pretty much, in cover from their spawn, and you can shoot into their spawn from their position and stop people from going to A, at least, from the outset area. I mean, you still have people that can come in from A using their buildings, but it's going to be a lot more tough to do. Now, on the other side of the map, you have this spot here, which if you can get too quick, you can shoot across the map pretty much and into their spawn. Although the Centauro doesn't have the best gun depression, so that's going to be interesting to see what's going to happen with that. Now, jumping over to the top side of the map, which is also very interesting, I should say, there's two things are going on here. This team, the right team, I suppose, has this pretty amazing hill to camp on, pretty much, and shoot people that are going C, and some people that are going B in this open area. And you can shoot pretty much in their spawn for the most part if they're not paying attention, because they can use the building as cover right here. Now, there's also a huge flank you can do, which is kind of dangerous because you will be open, to be shot at. But you can do it. You can go across, across the map pretty much, and go pretty much on the top of the map. There's a little like rocky area where you can stay and, also pretty much deny everybody going C. Pretty strong and scary position. Now on the contrasting side, on the left side, you also have some rocks to counter people flanking, of course. You can also just drive right to sea with a quick tank, although you really have to have a quick tank, otherwise you can get shot by the enemy. And there is this interesting area right here in D4 and 5 where you can get shots onto people that are coming up this hill. So that could be good counter. I've seen it being used. It's actually being used on me. When I tried to get on this hill, there was I think it was a T-34. That was on, D4-5, which shot me across the map, basically, denying me the position right here. It's a very risky position to go, especially if you don't have a quick tank.
Maybe the Chintaro will be the tank for the job, or, you know, maybe the R3-T20, but as we go, loading into the map, here we go, Middle East. The map that we, never thought would happen, but here we go.
Oh shoot, I have to switch the CLR. Pardon me, boys.
Well done. Prepared as usual.
Well, at least I notice it now, not later, right?
Well, one-man production team and doubling as a caster, you're not doing a bad job.
I'm trying. I'm trying my hardest. So yeah, as I talked about, the hill on here. Let's go back to Tang so I can show you guys more. So there's a few hills you can go on and pretty much camp. There's this actually this hill in the spawn which you can go to, which you can snipe into their spawn, as you can see here. You pretty much hold down, you can shoot onto like Alpha SRB right here. But if you push up, for example, to these rocks, you pretty much hold down, this entire, for example, and can shoot people coming out of this spawn. But on the contrasting side, you can also see you can drive up this hill and you have a very good spot there. So
Mystic?
Yeah?
They held back all their spawns, the madmen. And yeah. Now they've gone for the all-out. Botcher and Hezel Roll trading in the head-on. Ideal, but Oryx is also looking pretty sore.
Yeah.
Ah, yeah, that's not going to buff out.
Finish is, is alive
all
with
alone,
a bomb,
and
which can
be
scary.
Yeah. Although you have Zali with the Falcon, We've seen plenty of good plays, and Zali is one of those other good SPAA drivers that's absolutely insane. He's got his Tigger on his tank, and he's got some shark
flag.
Mouth with it. What is going on with that Tigger? I have no idea. But
wait, what?
Yeah, have a look at his Tigger.
I like that. That's amazing.
Botcher spawning back in the Kika, despite Mr. Zali here.
Well, two targets is more to worry about than one target, so it could
be
used to their advantage.
Yeah, that's true. You can always distract. And here we go with the madmen capping A and Nasty capping C.
Yeah, it's interesting.
So it looks like we're going to have a fight over B.
Yeah, I like that Niels is taking Fosh in this position. It's quite good. The Conqueror might not see this coming. Oh, God. Does he see it coming? Ooh, he barely misses the Conqueror. He got this track,
really,
but that's pretty much nothing.
You know, the only thing you have over that is you can rain Artie down on him, but then again, it's not really reliable.
Hawaiian is seeing if he can get onto the points, but Major was blocking him, but he got bombed by Finish, so that means that A's pretty open, and now Niels is getting bombed as well by Botcha, so
yeah.
They pretty much they open up A, although it's only Vortex that is, ready to actually take the point, which he's quite far back, and the Conqueror is not the quickest tank on the block.
One thing you also have to realize is that Botcher is on his last spawn,
really?
And he has taken out, he's only gone 1-for-1. So,
yeah.
He hasn't done a whole lot of work, and, you don't just get kills in this game. You deny with positioning. You deny with your, using your noggin a little bit more and, just sort of denying area rather than raw fragging potential. And,
yeah.
Botcher may have just thrown away an entire match just by losing his plane early.
Yeah. Ooh, and most wanted got taken out by the Falcon played by Alpha.
Alpha.
Showing how scary a Falcon can be again. It's monster.
The only counters you really have here are your Russian tanks. The Russian tanks can't be penned from the side by the Falcon. Well,
you can, but it's you gotta get close, and they don't have to be. You don't want to have them angled, so it's difficult, right? So Hawaiian is gonna take A.
It looks like Madmen have gone for a sort of brawler heavy lineup. You can see T-54s, Lorraine 40T, a couple of STBs. No Chintoro, which kind of makes me sad, but
Egocentris takes down Oryx and has a beautiful, beautiful position as you look here. You can pretty much see the entire straight.
My lord.
Yeah, so you can see anybody that is going and gonna see if they can get A, he has a shot on, basically. It's quite a far shot, though, don't get me wrong. It's a pretty far shot. And he does have to be ready for it, because Most Wanted is he gonna cross? I don't know if he's gonna try to cross. I think he is. Yeah, he's looking. They're pretty much all looking at egocentrist position, because, you know, he is pretty much denying them from pushing.
Yeah, this looks like one of the big power positions in the Middle East map. And,
yeah.
You know, egocentrist is using that to his full potential.
Mm-hmm.
The madmen are two caps down. They don't have that third cap. It's neutral. And egocentrist is the one preventing them from capturing.
Yeah. I have no idea what the Vortex is doing.
Vulture seems to be holding his last spawn. He's really? Put Madman in a man disadvantage, but are Madman able to, you know, come and take that? They have three tanks stacked up on one corner. This isn't really looking good for Madman with the positioning. Clutching up together is not really ideal. You want a spread across the whole map.
Yeah.
You know,
kind of like Nasty got going on here. They got it pretty well spread on the map.
This is potentially why Nasty is coming first, you know?
Yeah. Oh, Oryx going to try to do something with the Harp production. Gets... Wow.
Oh.
What a... Dude, that cut is nuts, dude. So he shot the front, and he got all the way down to the Amarek, which is in the middle of the tank, pretty much. And
he's
takes down another... Oh, damn, he takes out most wanted.
He's almost got himself an ace.
No, Major is getting shot at. The four-second reload with the 300 mils of penetration is just monstrous.
Oh, he's going to get himself a fifth if he's...
He takes down Niels with his breach and stuff. Niels is on two crew, I believe.
Yeah.
Oh, Major shot him just now. So he's going to need to repair his bridge. And he's on two crew.
Ace denied for now.
So that means they can move up for now.
Yeah, well, it gives them a little bit of a chance, you know.
Yeah.
They could have also used smokes, but, you know, I don't think any of them have packed them.
Finish is coming back into a kicker with a bomb, which is interesting.
Yeah.
He can get a double kill now on Major and Niels. Oh, God.
Oh, well, no. It looks like he's going for them.
Here it comes.
This is why you don't stack up, ladies and gentlemen.
And there they go.
That's why you don't stack up.
Yeah,
that's plain and simple.
He was trying to repair his buddy, but with an 800 kilogram bomb, it doesn't work out as well.
Yeah,
so Fling's seeing if he can get Hawaiian guitar off the point. It's gonna be. Oh, I don't know if he can do it. Sally is going for B. I like that. He's going to get the... hopefully, they're probably hoping to stop ticket bleed at least. But they also have to cap or decap another point. Ego is still repairing his tank. Heads of a Roll is probably just waiting for him to come out. It's Niels against Alpha in the air, by the way. We've got a Spitfire and... Ooh. Oh! Alpha almost got him with the RP3s. God damn. That would have been pretty nasty. So it seems like he's going for Boccia.
Mystic, take a look at the ground. There goes Boccia.
Yep.
That's him out of the game. That is Boccia out of the match.
And he might go for Hawaiian now. He's going for the head on. He dies. And I don't think... No, he cannot get a bomb onto a guitar. He's not going to drop it, because otherwise he would have killed Flings there, and that wouldn't have been good. That would have been pretty disappointing. Ooh, Hawaiian is going for the push. Bad mistake, because he, you know, the Conqueror has quite a lot of penetration. Although, I think he had to make a move there, because Major was coming at the ice for him. Although, I think he might have been better off just... facing off against the ice frame, although then Flings could push. That's the thing about having a 2v1 is that no matter what you do, you're at a big disadvantage. So
speaking of disadvantage, it looks like the Nasty guys were in a man disadvantage.
Yeah. Oh.
And here comes Zally with the rockets.
He's beautiful rockets.
Absolutely amazing work. Him and Arpet seem to be the rocket gods today.
Yeah, it seems that way. They did great work. And now he's going to go for egocentric. No, he's going for Zedrox, actually, in this Conqueror. And he hits his track, so that will mean...
Only the tracks.
It will buy some time. He has to watch out for the MX-30, actually, because that 20 can rip you apart. That thing is scary if you get good with 20 mil. It's kind of difficult to get used to, because if you elevate the gun, the 20 mil also elevates at the same time. So that means
but it doesn't elevate to the same level. It's not on the same axis. I believe the 20 mil is on a separate axis.
Yeah, it can elevate like 45 degrees, I believe.
Yeah.
It is quite a good anti-aircraft gun, but it is something to get used to, because if you elevate the gun, if you want to elevate the 20 mil, and if you elevate the main gun as well with that, it'll elevate like double the rate. So most of the time you don't expect it to be elevated so high. So most of the time, for me, I always like overcompensate, the 20 mil.
You do get that case, and it looks like, who have we got actually in that vehicle? Ego Centrist is not really able to make the most of it.
We got, it's quite equal in terms of deaths, because both teams lost at least one guy, at least two guys.
Two, yeah.
And,
God, Zally with the next rocket?
Oh, wow. I didn't even see that. Nicely done.
He got the back of the turret, ammunition's in the back of the turret, and that was
that's
absolutely stunning.
That's just showing how, knowing game knowledge is very important. Most wanted is pretty much the only guy denying them from getting B, which is
Falcon.
It's tough.
Up in, now there's a Falcon up, so good luck with your air. Mm-hmm. Any heavy tank is probably going to be short work for Ego Centrist, who's coming in with a bomb, with two bombs in the Bearcat, and the Bearcat I believe can also penetrate the top of the Foch.
No,
it's got the no. Oh
no, the 20 mil is. I don't know if it's bugged or not, but I believe it only really penetrates like 8 millimeters of armor in the files, and it has like basically no post pen effect on the AP. So it's like their spawners are more useful anti tank guns than these. Even like pretty much any gun, I would say. But he's going for the bomb on Most Wanted, which will take him out. So that means that Zetrox and Alpha can take B. And now Major is also going to go down by a bomb. So that means Flink is in a big problem. And there you go. Now Flink is pretty much alone on the map. This is not looking good. Hezor all can spawn one more time. And Flinks can spawn two more times, but that's pretty much the only things they have left. And, I don't know. They can't win this anymore. So that match is going to nasty. It looked quite good for Madman at the start of the match, but they crippled. Nasty got that back very well at the end. With, the double kill from finish. And, just overall better use of bombs. I would say. That was the first round going to Nasty. That's 1-0 for Nasty. Very nice. Oh, I see. So Spitz's PC just crashed, I suppose. So we'll just need to wait for him for a bit. But that was interesting to see. As you see, in a tournament, it's an interesting map. I don't know if I still don't like it, per se. But that position that Ego Centrist had, it just demolished Madman at the start of the match. They couldn't push, because it... 4 second reload, 300 millimeters of penetration with a ton of post pen effect on that shell that Lorraine has. It is just, it is not an invincible wall, but it's a scary wall to get through. Let's show the post game stats here. Ego Centrist with 6 kills. That is quite some killing with, is Lorraine what he did there. And with the bumps as well, he's pretty much their star player, it seems. Alpha as well, 4 kills, very nice. And Finish, also 4 kills, so a double bomb kill. And the starting kill in his RTY2. So yeah, it was a good use of their planes, and especially that Lorraine. It was very, very well played. No, Sally with the Falcon also trying his best, and with the rockets. Sally is very, very good with the rockets right now. So yeah, that's that was interesting. So on to the second match we go. Now with African in, which was Spit talk, you know, Spit was talking about him being just a beast basically. So let's see how it goes for Madman with African in, which seems to be taking the British, which is interesting. I don't know, like, I haven't really seen the British being used that well on this map. The Conquerors were certainly not bad, per se, but I think it just showed how well French tanks can be with that beast reload, especially on the Lorraine, and that the AP doing so much damage. And also, was it Most Wanted? Oh, I might be wrong. It's either the Most Wanted or Major, which was... No, it was not Major, because he was playing... it was Niels, sorry. It was Niels in his MX50 Foch, which basically denied them, you know... Denied Nasty pushing up, but he did get bombed out, you know? You have so much armor, but it's not going to save you from... What was an 800-kilogram bomb? Yeah, it's... that it doesn't survive that. So, but if you can use the tank to its maximum effect, it's just a wall, you know. The MX50 Foch, so much frontal armor, basically only penetrable by heat, and if you have APHE you could go for the cupolas, but it's, you need to aim for it, right? And with a 120mm AP round that can penetrate up to like 300mm, you don't really need, you know, you don't really need to aim for many of these tanks, especially, well, except for stuff like the IS-4, which are quite quite chunky. Volume a little to booms and dakas. All right, let's do that. Change the sounds then. I it's also put down for this stream. Let's put it on 33. Let's see how that goes.
All right, I'm back.
Welcome back. Your PC crashed. What happened?
So this has happened about 3 times already, and oh, I'm starting to get concerned. But my PC will either be, you know, it's happened twice when I'm in a game and twice while I've been watching a stream.
Oh damn.
My PC has literally just turned off. It's like someone has flicked the PSU and just gone, nope, you're not working anymore.
How old is it? How old is your PC?
It's a year and a half. Or almost 2 years old.
Maybe it's just a faulty component just messing up.
Yeah. Well, I might take it to a computer store.
I would definitely do that.
I don't have the parts to sort of switch everything out and try it.
Yeah.
But you know, it's happened 4 times.
The match is starting, by the way. If you
make content, and yeah, I mean.
Okay, good.
I saw Nasty 1, and I'm really disappointed because I must have left at the turning point that Nasty was sort of about to come through, right?
Wait, what?
I disconnected at about the time that the Nasty guys were.
I didn't even know you DC'd from the match.
Yeah. I completely DC'd, like the computer just shut down.
God damn.
Like the screen went blank first and then...
Yeah, they... oh man, shoot, who did that? Egocentris actually bombed out Major and Most Wanted on the B cap, so they could take B, and then they just took out Flinks and I was the only guy left.
Easy game.
Yeah. They
looks like...
I said in the post game that they use their bombs a lot, I would say a lot better, and you know.
Mm. Yeah, well, I mean, getting that double kill, especially, mm-hmm. you know, trading 2 vehicles for 1, yeah. very, very quickly. That's, you know, that's something that you can't really understate. And
I like that Nasty seems to have like a
oh,
a more direct
hit roll with the bomb kill.
Oh really? Oh damn! I didn't
oh
see it.
Oh my god!
Oh wait, what?
No way!
God damn! Why do I miss all this stuff?
No way!
What in the world?
What?
So Oryx seems to be going for a suicide bomb on Ego. But Ego is spawn protected, so he's not going to take him out. So that means that Butcher is still in the air with the bomb, which is going to go on Major, so he doesn't get the cap. There he goes. Falls by the 800 kilogram bomb, which is just a piece of bomb. So Hawaiian has like no opposition, you know, to go to the cap. Well, besides from Zali, but I don't think Zali can shoot, can he? Oh, he might be actually. Ooh, he takes out the commander and loader, and his bridge is now red. So he needs to repair for a second. But he, I think he's gonna get the point in time. Zephyrox has to make a move. He is gonna stop the cap. But, you know, the Conqueror is now coming as well. Vortex is gonna be... I think Zali just got in the cover in time. Oh, he sees Vortex incoming now.
Oh, it's looking hairy for
yeah.
Zali. He's on fire.
Ooh, yeah, and Zali is gonna go down by the Conqueror, it seems. But, is he gonna cap the point in time? I don't know.
That's a real potential, because whilst the Conqueror does have the edge, it's very possible that Zali could get the shot
he
up.
He will
oh, no,
cap in time, I think.
Oh, he set him on fire. Yeah, he
yeah,
will cap in time.
He will cap in time, so we will get the early cap on. Niels is in his flush again, I like it. And he's gonna... He can actually shoot Vortex if he's gonna push up. He seems to be trying, but he just... I think he just missed, it seemed. I believe so. Where's Vortex? Oh wait, I think he actually got his commander. But Niels is in a very cheeky position. He missed again, it seems. Vortex is getting quite lucky. Oryx capped B point, and it seems like Nasty got the C point with Egocentrist in it, and Zetrox is actually going back for a different position. Now,
yeah, even though we're 4 minutes into the match, it seems like Madmen are getting a nice good hold onto the town, and
yeah.
that's leaving the other guys to sort of just clean up and try and, you know, try and take it back.
Mm-hmm.
They have really got some good tanks to do that. They have a Horu production, which is really good for pushing, and it's really good for holding down an angle.
Yeah.
And you've also got the T-54, which is a really good city brawler.
Yeah, it really is. The side armor is nice for side scraping. The front armor is pretty damn good. I honestly don't know if they get... Do they get the 47? Yeah, right, they do.
What was that?
The T-54 1947.
Yeah, they do, and they get the 51. Because there's really no point in the 49. It's
just, yeah, it's just the in-between 51. One, but it sucks at like both things.
It's got nothing that either one of them are good at. It's got less armor and poorer shells.
Yeah, I mean, you've got APDS, but honestly, nobody's going to use APDS on the T-54. Major seems to be using heat, though, which is interesting for his T-54.
Yeah, I've noticed that there are a lot of T-54s here using heat. And that's probably to counter the other T-54s that are also using heat
and
as
the
well.
Fosh, I think. At least, well, ooh, I like it. Hawaii just missed the Capota shot on Niels. He's using APS heat to get that Capota shot, because I don't think he can penetrate the front with this shell. Which is, well, maybe. 380 mils of pen. He might be able to. But yeah, Madman is looking pretty decent right now. Flings is... Ooh. Zetrox just missed the shot on Flings, so he's gonna live for now. But he is gonna... You know, he did stop C being capped for a second. So that's interesting. African is also in a position where he can pretty much deny Ego from pushing on at least one side of the cap point, and he's gonna stop Zedrox from pushing all the way to flanks in his Lorraine.
Yeah, African Hut again with the support plays that are just absolutely dominating.
And you know, pretty much denying areas, position.
Denying positions, and ultimately just being an awesome fragger. And the Conqueror is one of the better tanks to do this thing in because you can just sort of sit hull down.
Yeah.
In this case here, you're covered by rocks. You don't need to expose your hull, which is absolutely pathetic when it comes to armor. And there he goes.
Yeah.
Beautiful shot onto the ammo rack.
Zedrox didn't see that one coming. That's for sure.
Oh boy, he's gonna feel that one in the morning as well.
Yeah. Oh, if he feels anymore, that is. Because it seems like his toes are quite blown off.
It's not the only thing that's just blown off.
Yeah.
There goes his, turret as well, I think. You know, it's crazy.
I like it because I like this match because it shows that Madmen, they play a lot different than Nasty did in this in the same map, right? They don't have Lorraine sitting here like egocentrist, which shooting down the entire road. They have Niels instead locking Nasty down to get to A. The same with Zali here in Major. They got A down.
Yeah, well, it's also that the guys from Nasty have taken the C cap instead of taking it from the other side.
Yeah.
And the fact that Madmen are actually contesting that for once means that power position there that Egocentrist absolutely brutalized them with.
Speaking of Niels, he's going down by bombs.
Unlucky ducky by Niels. It's looking pretty even in terms of the man count, although I will say that I think Madmen has a slight edge with two people who haven't died yet, African Hut and Flix, and Boccia again in the Kika.
Oryx is going down, it seems.
Dead twice. And Hawaiian Guitar.
Actually, yeah, he does. He goes down by the Falcon, actually, because he got out of the way of the bomb, but the Falcon, he just ripped him apart.
I mean, that's what a bomb's good for. If it doesn't take them out of position, it outright kills them. So, you have
such a powerful vehicle. Heads of a roll, got pent in the front by the Falcon. Which, can, because it has like a very... It has a turret ring, so you can pen that.
Yeah, it's got a really weak turret ring, and you should be able to shock trap it as well, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Zedrox is using his Spitfire very well. He put flanks on fire. African Hut, though. Ooh, he's in a bad position. Look at African here. What's he doing? He got stuck.
Oh, wow.
What's happening? Oh, God. As good as that web.
Oh, my.
But he takes him out.
God.
By a ammo rack in the turret. What a shot. What in the hell is going on?
What is going on?
So Flinks can actually take the point now. What in the world is that? But Flinks is going to be set on fire again by the Spitfire. And Egocentrist is now... Oh, yeah, but he did take the point. But Egocentrist is coming in now with bombs.
Taking out that Falcon.
Yeah.
I told you it'd be the African Hut Show. I told you so.
Yeah, basically. Oh, that was beautiful to see, man. I love that. Of course it's African. It's always African.
I love it. It's just too good, man. It's too good.
It really is.
There he is again now. African Hut again, using that road, that position to deny the push. And this time, Madmen have three caps.
Yeah. Egocentrist did bomb Major. And he's going to bomb Zali now, so that means Hawaii can go and take the A point pretty much. Do we have that bomb hits though? And it will. Oh, actually. Wait, who? Oh no, the Centurion actually killed him.
Yeah.
Damn, that was a smart idea. It was like a. It's just a bait of a. To get Zali out. And he's going to bomb Oryx.
These crossfires is super important in War Thunder. You set up a good angle and take it well. And oh my god, Nasty getting taken out by African Hut. I'm telling you, this is the African Hut Show.
Yeah.
He's already on 4 kills. He's racked himself up a 4-piece. He's reloading another APDS shell. And my guess is he's going to take on Finn Tiger now. Is he gonna get the ace?
He's on a strong position now. You know, is it stronger with the? It's different. It's just a different experience with either the Conqueror or the Lorraine, because the Lorraine can just, you know, hold down the your mouse button and just shoot every second or so, because the auto load on the pack, that thing is mad.
It's more like the Lorraine has the rate of fire and the Conqueror has the, you know, positional advantage. Yeah.
As the stabilizer, you know, as the turret armor.
Yes, exactly. And whilst Finnish Tiger does have a good chance against the Conqueror, able to shoot that Cupola weak spot.
That could be, ooh, that could be scary for him.
Yeah, although Finnish Tiger is burning. He's not looking in a, he's not in a good way.
Well,
he's
African
pretty much
sees
down.
Boccia moving up, so.
Boccia's also on his last spawn as well, if I'm not mistaken. Again, Boccia with the late spawns. And we are 12 minutes in, looking like...
Yeah, this is...
Looking really strong for Mad Men. They have the positioning, they have the caps, they have a massive ticket advantage. And honestly, if Mad Men just want to win, I think staying alive will be just fine.
Basically. Boccia just messed up a shot. Oh, damn, I didn't want to click that. But so did African.
Yeah, that's a bit of a rarity happening from African. He's in a bit of trouble here. He's got Boccia.
I'm not sure on why Boccia is being so passive now. He can push and kill him pretty easily.
Yeah. Maybe he doesn't know that he...
No, he misses a shot.
Oh, here comes African. Is he going to get his ace?
Yeah.
He gets his ace!
There you go. Shuts him down.
What did I tell you? African Hut Show. We are looking at a fantastic game from African Hut. 5 kills without a single death. And he's managed to hold the entire C point all match for all 13 minutes without taking so much as a little bit of commander damage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that commander's pretty resilient. All he's done is fallen asleep and
he's gonna wake up tomorrow.
Unconscious. It's okay.
He's gonna have a headache tomorrow. That's about it.
Yeah, I mean, it is African Hut. You know, this guy is something else. Mad Men have got a really good pick here, but
Sally taking out Alpha. Ooh. Can he? He's gonna shut down the barrel of Hawaii. I love it. That's what you can do with, you know, AAs like this. You can just demolish the entire barrel of that tank, and it's looking like it's a stubby by now.
Yeah.
Hawaii.
He's got his tracks out, and it looks like it's just an easy pick for Master.
There you go.
Major. Yeah. Looking good.
Finish did take the B cap, but it's just not gonna do anything at this point.
Nah, I don't see the nasty guys winning this. Look at the scoreboard, man. Look at the scoreboard. You have a bunch of people with lots of kills.
Yeah.
And then you also have a bunch of people with none. But a bunch of people with none are the ones that are putting the positioning in. So they don't really see a scoreboard.
But they're just denying the enemy to just push. So
exactly.
It's
that's their role.
Killing is important, but denying the enemy to get kills or to push through these caps is also very, very important, especially when you're talking to, you know, about 15-minute matches, which just end up so quickly.
Yeah, that's exactly right. You know, we've seen an absolutely entertaining performance by the Mad Men, and this is exactly why I have so much respect for the Mad Men. They know their stuff really, really well, and you know, they said in the chat yesterday that they didn't actually have a plan for Kuban, but you know, their ability to think on the fly, you know, they're the team that doesn't have to have that pre-prepared strategy. They can think on the fly, they can adapt as they go, and this is what makes them such a strong team.
Yeah, but the thing is, they just won on the same side, Nasty won on, so, and the sides are going to flip again, so. It's going to be interesting to see what Madman is going to do now. Are they just going to go in like Nasty? Like, Nasty seems to have like a predetermined plan on, you know, we're going to do two planes, we're going to do an AA, we're going to do two tanks on the ground, and the other two tanks, we'll just wait and see what Madman does. And Madman just seems to do, I think, two tanks about that on the ground, and then they just wait on what Nasty is going to put in.
Yeah, and that's the key to getting these victories. You know, you have to play to the counter of your enemy. And holding off those spawns, obviously you don't want to hold them off for too long.
No.
But imagine 15 minutes without spawning. You know, you're wasting yourself. But if you can hold it off for about 30 seconds until you can figure out a counterplay to what they're doing, that is when you can really get behind your or get into your enemies. I swear I thought I saw an Italian flag loading into the lobby here. You guys... Someone was teasing me with that Centauro.
Hold up, let me do it.
Come.
There you go.
No, he's so mean. He's so mean. Fine, I'll join the Italian voice.
Poker is Italian.
Actually, one thing that I haven't found is no one's playing Americans.
No,
it might be because the M60 is subpar.
It's not very good, I would say.
No.
Against Heat, it doesn't do anything special. Against APHE, it just crumbles because the cheeks are weak, the mantle is weak, it has a giant cupola. We're talking about the commander's cupola of the, what was it called? The Conqueror, which is quite big, but it's pretty well armored for as cupolas goes.
Well, it's 114 millimeters thick, but
it's quite angled as well.
Very far forward as well. It is really, really close to the gun breech, and right next to the gun breech is the good old ammunition.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you have a good APHE shell, it's going to one shot. You know.
Yeah.
Back in the day, everyone used to say, you know, if you've got your T10M or your IS4M, chances are at range, you may not pen that mantlet. So. Especially with the AOS, which I believe has an improved mantlet, you just absolutely have to kill that, hit that cupola, and the cupola is almost always a one shot. I remember, I think I must have been in my IS3. I've even done it in my Leopard 1.
I've done it in the Type 61. No, Type 61. Is it the Type 62? I had a test drive on it. That was a while back when test drives weren't completely spaded out the gate. But I killed an M60 through the cupola, which is pretty funny.
With 85mm APHE.
Yeah. So
that's
a good meme. Because I was on the cap and he was trying to push me, but he was gonna try to come over the hill, but you know the cupola is giant, so you can just see that right out of the gate.
That thing sticks out like a sore thumb.
So yeah, it's a big target. Now. The Americans also get the Magach, which is, it's interesting. It is quite slow as a medium tank scope, but it has quite decent armor in terms of like, it gets this Blazer ERA, is it? I think so.
Yeah, Blazer. The Israelis, I believe it's French developed and Israeli used. Oh, now, to compensate for the lack of mobility, the Israelis actually upgraded the engine. But it's not much more noticeable because you have got those ERA bricks.
It's not really an
not only that
upgrade per se. It's a change of engines because I think they went from the M48. I think it was probably a gasoline engine, right?
Mm-hmm.
They went to a M60 engine and transmission, I believe. So it's probably to get it more streamlined in production. It's my guess. I have no clue, to be honest. But it's just some information.
There's something I've noticed with literally every Israeli modification. For some odd reason, they just change the engine out on everything.
Yeah, all the basically.
Time. You know, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, but even the Super Sherman, they changed out the engine. The Magach, really? They changed the engine.
Damn.
Maybe not the Sherman, but I know for sure... The Magach super... and the Shotgal for sure.
Yeah, the Shotgal is the I think it's a Meteor. I might be wrong on this though, but I think it's the Meteor engine.
The Meteor engine was the one that they had on the Centurion. It might have been.
Oh, then it's then because... it's a different one, I think. But
you know,
I'm not the historian.
The best thing about the early Centurions and I believe the Comet as well is they were powered by the Merlin engine, but for ground.
Oh yeah, that's so right.
It's a Spitfire engine,
basically,
and that gets points in my mind. You know,
Americans also did the same, but they had a radio engine.
A radio engine.
You know,
the term to turn over the engine actually comes from that radial engine, because you would physically have to rotate it 180 degrees to get the oil to flow back through the engine so it didn't flood it when it started.
God, what's going on in the chat? What the crap? Oh my god.
So we have more R2Y2 spawning right off the bat, and yeah, it looks like Finnish Tiger's the only one up in the air for the nasty guys.
Yeah, and he's staying behind. He knows that he's going to be at a big disadvantage. Ooh, the first bomb drop coming in, but it missed on, I think it was an ego, but it missed quite badly.
Yeah, I think, you know, now that they have time to sort of figure out what they're doing, they should have taken their time with those bombs, because Finnish Tiger is really playing this really passively.
Oryx still has a bomb left, though, and it's going to go on the flower, I believe, if Alpha doesn't take him out. That's scary coming in with the Falcon on your side. The Falcon actually hits the engine and the cupola. Oh, well, not the cupola, what is it called? The cockpit, there you go. The cockpit of Oryx, but he survives, so.
And the engine's also black as well, so. Yeah.
But he still lives.
Yeah, well, that's the major part, and he's going back to base. Finnish Tiger, however, is just sort of cowering over his airfield, doing nothing.
Yeah. He's waiting for a golden opportunity, maybe. Major are taking the point.
The only problem is, you need that man advantage. Otherwise, you know,
yeah,
a man doing nothing, you know, better off not spawning at all.
Yeah, well,
because that's
yeah, I suppose so.
Yeah, more or less.
So Niels again, I like it. I like that he's taking out the Fush. It's. I love that this is just not all the same tank, because you know,
it's
for
charming.
Example. In the first Thunder League, basically everyone was in a T-44.
Yeah, it was like T-44 and BF-109 G6 League.
Yeah, it's basically that. And this tournament is it's such a big variety, because you got the French with the Lorraine and the Foch, and maybe I suppose the MX-30 or the BF-109. Yeah. You got the Japanese with the R2YTs, the Kika and the SDB. You got the British with the Conqueror, which has been showing very strong results, and the Falcon, which is also just a monstrous AA.
Oh yeah, it's absolutely fantastic having that thing.
And also the Vickers and the Centurion Mark 10.
I wish the Saddam was in here as well.
Yeah, I think that would have. I don't know. I still think the Falcon is better of all. It's a lot smaller.
More penetration as well.
And more pen, yep.
But it still is a solid pick for an AA. Maybe it'll give the Italians a reason to be picked, you know?
African and Zali taking out Hawaii here. Zali got taken out by Ego Centrist, which is... Oh, look at Ego again. He's going for that position. Which, I don't know if it's not that useful at the moment, because it's only Flinks that really is in a position to, you know, go over that street.
Yeah, well, it seems like they've already pushed up beyond that point, just a little bit too far. You know, is it really going to be effective? Time will tell.
Yeah. You got Finnish, isn't in a... Is it Finnish crash or something? Oh, yeah, Finnish got shot down by the R2Y2, actually. So
he's in his hurry, and he's taken out our hero, African Heart.
Ooh.
No more crazy plays from him in the Conqueror.
Niels pretty much shutting down the road for Vortex here. And Major against Flower. The Ice Frame is a scary target. You know, he's going to go side scraping. Ooh. I don't know if that's going to go well for Major here. Oh, yeah. Actually, Flower messes up the shot. So that means he could try and go for the trap shot, I suppose. Because I don't think anyone is... Yeah, he actually went for the trap shot. Very nice shot from Major here. Shutting down the Ice Frame on the A cap. Hawaii tried to shoot Major, but he was pulled back too far already, so he missed the shot. Now, Finnish is... Oh, he pushed up. That's a match of fire, I can say. He's just... He can't really do anything at the moment.
He's gonna risk getting outflanked if he's not careful. I mean, he does have a shell loaded in the breach, but...
Yeah.
Remember, a tank destroyer can only point one way, and that's the way that the gun's facing.
Mm-hmm. And the thing is, if Finnish wants to push up, for example, for Major, he really needs backup from somebody. Like Hawaii, maybe? Hawaii could get a shot now. But he does not. Although, he might see the opportunity now. Yep, he sees the opportunity. He's gonna go for it. Oh, he just ricochets over the turret. That's a sad moment for him.
Have a squeeze at the south spawn, Mystic. You have Vortex here, who's trying to sort of jockey with the boss.
Yeah, he's been doing that for 5 minutes now.
This might buy Flowerbug enough time to sort of get into the town.
Hmm. Yeah, you're right. Flinks, though, is also in a position to... I think he might have a shot on to finish if he wants to go on the point. And Flower is... I don't know if he's in a good position either. Ooh, Major actually gets his gunner and commander taken out. And his bridge is red. And his... A loader is also red, which is gonna, you know, switch the gunner's position, so the turret rotation is gonna be a lot lower on the T-54 now.
He's also getting artillery called on him, so, you know, this could spell the end. He's got a red crew member, so any more damage to that gunner, and he's toast.
Ego Centris, by the way, he got taken out, so that means Oryx, Zali, and Flings, and African all could push up, so they're gonna, you know... They're gonna help Major here. 8 minutes left on the clock, by the way. Neil's trading shots with Ego and Vortex now. Two Fostures against each other. Can he do something?
I think unmovable objects here.
Yeah, I don't think either can pen each other. So it's like, what do you do? There's nothing you can do against each other. So that's kind of lame.
This is the Battle of Papegas right here. Or peepees, if you want to put it that way, you know.
Oh, Niels, I mean, he got one crew taken out, but, I mean, I think the two crew in the hole, I don't think they can be penned by the Amex 50, and Ego, he knows that, and he's going for another flank. Maybe taking B. By the way, B being taken by Oryx now, but he got taken out by Zetrox. Where is Zetrox at? Oh, I see. Zetrox is in a hold on position in his Conqueror. So that's pretty strong.
Really nice positioning, actually. You've got those little rocks around the B cap. Yeah. You know, when this map was introduced in the 2016 April Fool's event, 2017 April Fool's event, these rocks were often a hotbed for combat, and you can see exactly why. They're just so good for staying hull down. They're so good for... Yeah, they're a good power position. You know, you can deny the whole map.
Yeah.
Maybe Zetrox will see Oryx there.
That's By the way, Niels just penetrated the roof of Vortex here. So that's interesting. I didn't think you could do that.
Oh my god.
But you can, I suppose. Major is gonna... Ooh, Major is gonna be in a little bit of trouble now. Because both Finnish Flower and Ego Centris in his what should we call it? The MX50 Fosh are pushing up. He's gonna be in a tough position. Although I suppose Major can shoot the cupolas of the MX50 Fosh. Oh, Flower and Finnish are both going for the cap point.
I don't know if you've noticed, but Boccia isn't in this match. I was looking for the two deaths guys, and you know, we've got Flower, we've got Hawaiian, and we've got Ego.
Speaking of Flower, on the Madman side, it's only Oryx. M9. Flower just took out M9 on the point Major, so they're gonna cap A. But Oryx is on C, so they're gonna have that point, and now they don't have any AA up anymore. So that means that Niels is actually going to come in to the with the 84, the French one, which has two bomb drops, and, well, a metric Aston of rockets, and also Zali coming in with the Spitfire again, with his beautiful tiger. I love that.
Tigo is absolutely amazing.
What in the world, man? So yeah, let's see how that's gonna go for him. Because now they're on a on the cap disadvantage, and the thing is, there's only 5 minutes left, so...
Oh, wow.
They... Nasty really has to keep these points for just a few minutes to get the cap advantage, and then, you know, they'll pretty much win the match. It's going to be over in a second. Zedrox now is in a Falcon, trying to deny the 84, which, you know, is understandable.
Yeah, the 84 is the priority target here, looking pretty strong. Oh my god, here goes Niels with the long-range rockets. Is he going to land any? Oh, he gets something close.
And he takes out the Falcon. Heads, actually, he takes out the Falcon.
Heads with the ram.
So that means, like, that Niels and Zali... Niels taking out Centurion, the Alpha SRB and the Centurion. Very dude, he's so good at these rockets, what the hell?
it's crazy. This is some...
Oh my god, he's insane.
Ridiculously special stuff. We're seeing a really massive push come out here from Oryx Niels.
Oryx taking back B. Oh god, this is bad for Nasty right now. Niels...
Wowbug gets a big oof with that bomb. You know, the big 2,000 kilo bomb. Or 2,000 pound bomb. And now Niels has some rockets to dish out to either the Conqueror or the IS-4M. Remember that these rockets have up to 450 millimeters of pen, and out goes the driver.
Yeah. Zedrox and Alpha are both in Spitfires trying to combat them. But is that a good choice? I don't know. These guys are very good in their... You know, at least Zali, for example, is just very good in his... very comfortable in his Spitfire. And he's going to take out Alpha here, which is going into a flat spin. So that means that Zedrox and Zali are in a 1v1. And I think Zali... Well, they might have a head on. Yeah, they have a head on right now.
That's going to be a trade. Oh, never mind.
Yeah, it is kind of a trade, but Zedrox still lives, and he's going to bomb Flinks, it seems. But is it going to be enough? Is Major also decapped the point? African is also incoming into A. Oryx got B. Flinks is, you know, pretty much going into the middle of the map, and Heads will back up B.
Not only that, to add a little bit of insult to injury, Zali manages to get finish Tiger just before he gets that C-cap, denying him the push. We're looking at a really, really close matchup in the dying seconds of the game, and I think it's down to Vortex. Whoa!
And I think that's dude, that was a close match. Madman actually taking the win here. Oryx actually got a beautiful shot onto Vortex, by the way, across the map. Showing, you know...
last-minute push.
Yeah, that was an exciting last minute.
Absolutely crazy. Madman taking this one out.
Yeah.
Very Oryx nicely in the done. Five kills. Looking pretty fine, and Zali again with the three-piece. You know... Oh, actually, Zali's got himself a five-piece if you count the planes.
Yeah.
We're looking at some really, really strong players on the side of Madman.
Zali... I would say Zali and African are... Well, not really in this battle, but African last battle was probably the MVP. Along with Zali. Zali this match, also just... very, very, very competent player. Especially Spitfire, he's been... very good with those rockheads, getting them on target and just shutting them down one by one.
Zali seems to be an absolute master when it comes to these cast runs.
Yeah.
Especially in the Mark 24 with those RP3s, it's looking really strong. He's just doing so well consistently, and it's just great to see some real good, damn strong skill. It's crazy.
If you look at the bracket, if you look at this score here, I honestly didn't really see Alpha play much in this match, to be honest. He played the Falcon, but he didn't really do much with that. And
he got himself one ground kill, you know, not doing too well, to be honest.
I didn't really see him in the match. Vortex pretty much being nailed down to his position the entire match because of Niels, you know, just being rock solid in his MX50 Foch.
And again, the immovable force against the the immovable object against the unstoppable force.
Yeah,
absolutely crazy.
The Flower and Finish, they could not really push Major because he was just on that point, just sitting waiting for people to push. Hawaii tried really hard to, you know, get Madman off the point, but to no avail.
I think this match, this round in particular, was more a case of Nasty having the really good positioning and Nasty sort of playing their vehicles really well, but just being unable to capitalize on getting those kills and just being unable to, you know, take out their opponents.
Yeah.
Mad Men obviously being the ones bringing home the chicken dinner, I suppose. And
that was I think that was beautiful to see, because Egocentrist tried to do the same thing in his Lorraine, but Madman expected that. So it's showing you that Madman knows that, you know that they know that Nasty is going to do certain things, so they're going to react accordingly for that. So that it's just beautiful to see.
Again, what we're seeing is constant adaptation. Both the teams that have won today have shown a level of adaptation that it's really nice to see. So obviously Thunderpants starting off with the Fosh in the first round on the left hand side, on the one side with the C cap as the home cap.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he's on the other map, on the other side, he starts off in the Lorraine 40T, runs for the center of the map and dominates from there that way, adapting to the different sides and adapting to the different style of play. And then, of course, you have in this second matchup, you have the Mad Men adapting to Egocentrist's play and also making a play of their own in that position that the Nasty guys were unable to capitalize on, that being African Hut with his ass.
Right, I'm going to update the bracket real quick on my stream so you can show it.
Yeah, let's have a quick squiz at the bracket. Mad Men on the top with 101 kills. Ooh.
101, wow. Well, still, that's... how many kills does Nasty have now?
141. Whoa, but they have lost 134 vehicles. So Mad Men is... I think Mad Men has the highest kill-death ratio in this whole tournament.
Oh, sorry. There we go. That's the bracket. So...
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That's insane.
Highest kill-death ratio.
Yeah. I mean, you know, showing how much a loss counts. Just getting... You know, Mad Men was... Were they third?
Fourth.
Were they fourth before? So they went up from being third or fourth to, you know, place one from facing Nasty. And Nasty getting knocked down to second place. Still very, very strong place they're at. If they just keep winning. It's going to be close between Nasty and Madman if they both just keep winning their matches.
Although I will say, Nasty did face off against the YRA guys in the first round.
Yeah.
In the second round, they faced off against Verve. Mm-hmm. And in the third round, they faced up against Madman. They still have OP and they still have the Leak guys to go through. And they also still have, I believe...
They're probably going to face against AV as well.
And your proxy as well.
Oh, and your proxy too, yeah. They got some strong competition.
They have a couple of tougher matches ahead of them, so it's possible that Nasty could slip a couple more if they're not careful. OP, though, I have to say, is... That was insane. That was absolutely
I loved watching that match. Just seeing them come back from... Well, kind of dead. from the first match.
I was honestly expecting, based on the first matchup, that they were going to end up in the top 10, barely in the top 10.
Mm-hmm.
And here they are at fourth place. With a very, very strong position above Enya Proxy, above Verve, which is sitting at 8.
By the way, we should do the giveaway now. Which the second... Oh, we didn't even talk about the second guy. So let's talk about the second guy right now. Completely forgot. Oh, did we? No, we did not. So
we did a little bit.
Let's talk about Nasty real quick. It's a funny story on when it was made. Because it was made on the 17th December. Sorry, let's start over. Nasty was made on the 17th of December in 2017, which is it's not that long ago. It's pretty new, to be honest. But the funny thing is, it was made on the 21st birthday of their captain, which is Zetrox. So it's pretty funny to know. In the morning when it was made, they all congratulated him, which is just such a wholesome story. I'm almost crying. It's so beautiful, man.
Heart, my soul.
So that it's pretty fun, and they've been, you know, I've not been that active following tournament news, but I've been following it, and Nasty is not a bad team at all. They know how Nasty's to play.
Constantly been showing up with some decent plays pretty often in a couple of tournaments. I've checked scoreboards and stuff like that, and you can see them always somewhere up there. And it's really nice to have, you know, a consistent roster of people that can play. It's pretty good.
Yeah. And, well, we already talked about Madman. They're also just a new team. I love this tournament because there's so many new teams, but there's also just some teams that I've just been playing since the game came out, basically, like AV and Verve, for example. So I love the mix and match of these teams.
I think it was Destroy who had an Alpha Testers badge on him.
Oh, really?
On one of his vehicles.
That's pretty awesome.
I'm pretty sure it was one of the Verve guys. Yeah, right. It's like really impressive. You have a lot of people that have been here since the very beginning of War Thunder, and it's pretty interesting to see. It's very rewarding as well.
We already talked about Madman on my channel, but let's go over it real quick.
twitch.tv/MrCan_ for those of you who are.
Let me get my link real quick.
Sick plug.
Yeah, sick plug. Just the sick pluggy Rony. There we go.
You've got to be a real gamer and spam it multiple times as well.
Oh yeah, sure. So they're going to be very confused right now because it's on a 2-minute delay, and I'm really dumb and I don't think about that stuff right now. So that's going to be very weird to see, but whatever, we'll roll with it.
you'll understand in 2 minutes time.
Let me put that in chat because.
But it's so far we've had an absolute we've had an absolutely amazing stream. So
yeah, that was amazing. I love these two matches. They're great. I think it's probably more interesting than the other days we had. Because OP against any Prox was just a stomp, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, them coming back from that is interesting to see. And what was the other match we saw? AV against Madman. That was a pretty interesting match, I should say.
I
think today was probably the best two matches we've seen, because I didn't think OP would win 2-0 from Verve here. I didn't see that coming at all.
That completely blew me away, without a shred of a doubt. Probably the best match that I've ever seen in War Thunder competitive battles, just because of the adaptation and the absolute sweep that they managed to get. They managed to get control of the entire square. They managed to hold it, especially in that second map. They held it for most of the damn game.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
There were a few really good moments as well. A couple of nice clutches from the Verve guys, taking back the square and then immediately taken back by the OP guys with an excellent counterplay. This is some of the best War Thunder esports that I've seen. It's so amazing.
All right, the info. It's an international team, basically. Basically just European, I think. I shouldn't say that. I think, who was it? African is, of course, from Africa. I think he's South Africa.
Yeah, he's South African, yeah.
And, let me get the team name. I think Zali is from... No, I don't want to be wrong on that. That could be pretty bad if I'm wrong on that. I don't want to say it. No. I know one of these guys is from Kuwait as well, I think.
Yeah, I think it's Oryx.
It's Oryx? Okay, yeah.
Might be Oryx.
I don't want to say it because I don't want to be wrong. And then they're going to rage at me in the Madman Discord, and don't want that. But yeah, they basically speak English, so, you know, the communication between them is, it's just good, you know, as you just saw, they...
Yeah, very solid.
They went from Nesta, which is a scary team to face, so, you know, if you can win against that, you have some, you know, one, very competent players, of course. And two, you got good communication going. So that's also what OP had. OP is also English speaking, so they got some good communication as well.
Yeah, 100% agree. It's just the really good communication and the really good teamwork that makes the team. All of these players individually are quite proficient. You know, all you have to do is take a quick squiz at their stat card, and, you know, most of the time the stats don't lie. These guys don't really, you know, they don't sit in BF109 F1s and four men. They are actually pretty proficient at the game. So
yeah, I love the copy pasta, by the way.
Oh, it's beautiful.
But yeah, let's go on the question of today, which is, let's first tell Zerba to open up the
pizza time.
So it can start. But the question is, because it's going to start in 2 minutes for them, you know, from this moment, is on which team member's birthday? No, I should redo that. Let me get it, actually. So I got the question ready for us. I don't want to mess it up, right? where is it? Ay, ay, ay. Can I get it here? Where is it now? Oh, no, no.
Trust me.
So, on whose birthday did... on whose 21st birthday did the nasty team get made? Right? Is that the way to put it? Yeah, on whose birthday did the nasty team...
On whose birthday was Nasty formed?
Yeah, there you go. On whose birthday was Nasty formed? Thank you, Spit.
There we go.
I'm such a pleb with English. God bless.
I mean...
So yeah, it is... It's pretty easy. It should be easy.
Yeah, it should be pretty straightforward. And then once again, you'll get the notification from Moobot, so you should be fine.
Yeah. So the poll is open. So if you know the answer, you don't have to do it exactly, because I think if it's capital or not, it shouldn't matter. So yeah, don't be scared that you're gonna mess up the name. I mean, you gotta spell it right, but you don't have to make the capital letters and stuff right. So.
And once again, if you do get wrong, then.
Yeah, big deal. Tomorrow's another one, so it's fine. And it's a small.
I mean,
you can always
check by making sure Moobot sent you the confirmation. So.
Yeah, true. That's true. I'll ask Zerba if people are getting into the giveaway, and if you know the answer, please only put the answer there, and don't put anything, you know, with it, because I don't think it works if you put more stuff with it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It works.
Spit. What are you doing? I love it.
Zerba, where are my golden eagles? Panther, looking for that extra 150. How much have you got, Panther? Like.
Just a little bit, just a little bit.
Was it you that had 80,000? Something like that? No.
All these guys.
Philip. Dortrabe, because. Yeah.
He did casting as well. Him,
gave him some G every time he casted, and he ended up with 90,000 golden eagles. And then he quit the game because he was burnt out. Oh, Philip. Number one Muppet. God bless him.
Okay. So I just ask when to close it, so we'll keep it up for like a few minutes, which
right,
is
keep it up for another couple minutes.
So if they Oh shoot, that means that we're gonna keep it open for 4 minutes now. because of the 2 minute delay.
Actually, you know what? Let's close it now in 2 minutes time. So
all right.
it's currently 20 past six in the morning. So I think at 22 past six in the morning for me, it will close, which is...
Yeah. I should put it in chat. Okay. Give... He is gone. Okay, Oryx is from... I spit white. Oryx is from Kuwait. So yeah, you're right. Who was from Germany then? Yeah... I didn't know Oryx was from Kuwait. I knew one of these guys was from Kuwait, but I didn't. I thought Oryx was German, actually. Damn. You don't even hear it in his.
Yeah, so did I at first, yeah.
I don't hear it in his accent that much because he played with. I believe he played with. Was it. Napalm? Yeah.
Yeah, Oryx has made a few YouTube videos, so again, just search for Oryx.
Yeah, a lot of these these guys have made
content videos. At the very minimum, at least montages. So you know, classics are OP. OP is literally jam packed with content creators. You know, Badady, you know, streamer, Thunderpants streamer, Lubu streamer, Sergey, nothing. Copsy is mainly streamer, but has also done a couple of montages. You know, Villacy. Montages, Upet, you know, the occasional stream, mainly trash content from Upet, you know.
Oh, dude.
I don't know what this guy is, man.
In before, you know, kick from Euros.
Every time I go into the Euros TeamSpeak, he kicks me because I don't know why, man. He must hate me.
Probably. Yeah.
Chippy again. He's put out like 3 videos.
Oh yeah, I mean, not everybody has the time, right?
Yeah. You know. Chippy's a bit of an old guard. He plays with Copsy a lot. They're like excellent wingmen. They work together so well. Panther again streaming, and Amriky also streaming. So you know, if you wanna, you know, put your name out in the chat, maybe people give you a follow. You know.
Yeah.
Actually, in fact, Panther is in the chat right now as Hipster Snowman.
Yeah, and so... he has 223 eagles left. So that's epic. I think Bodetti has an absolute crap ton of GE as well.
Yeah, Bodetti is also a master of tournaments. He's pretty good. I think he got his skills from the 1v1s. He's
played pretty much anything, to be honest. Stuff. He's played team tournaments. There we go. Finally got it. He played... I don't know. He didn't really play wall mode, but he played in the... with Epic in the Squadron Battles.
Squadron Battles, I'm pretty sure.
Which was that was a lovely showing. But yeah, so
giveaways.
Yeah, there you go. So isn't it Twitch, Payshort, Plastic Rubber Duck, Mixu, and White Clad. Congratulations.
Enjoy your golden birds.
Yes.
Yes. Link not in the description below. All right. So, this has pretty much been all we're looking at today, right? These are all the matches that have happened for today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are some nice matches. Let's actually see what's tomorrow.
I'm keen to have a squiz at tomorrow's matchups. These are going to be really, really good.
OP against Nasty.
This is going to be great.
You know, Verve actually won one match against Nasty, but they lost two against OP. So it's going to be interesting if OP is just going to come back and just smack everybody in the face.
You know, OP, you know, they've shown that they can pull themselves together. If they can do that against Verve, I'm pretty sure they can do that against Nasty.
Yeah. We've got Leeds against SQ, which is... I think that would be interesting as well.
That's going to be interesting. Hopefully we see some more AMX13 action.
Oh, God. Any proxy against Madman? That's... interesting. I think Madman will win that.
I think they will, but I think it'll be a 2-1.
The thing is, Madman already won against AV, and AV won against AU Proxy.
That's true.
So, I don't know. It's, anything goes,
Madman
pretty much.
Madman are looking really strong here.
Yeah. They are.
So, could go anyway.
They pretty much got rid of, like, one of the more difficult teams to face.
Yeah.
Well, two of the most more difficult teams to face, AV and Madman. AV and Nasty, sorry. You know, those are strong players. Oh, those are strong teams, I mean. So,
yeah.
You know, if you can get rid of any proxy as well, and then you're left with Verve and OP, that probably will, have a chance on actually winning against Madman. So, yeah.
Yeah, we've also got YRA versus Verve and GGEs versus ABLOL. GGEs and ABLOL, literally someone is going to turn out with a victory here.
It feels like ABLOL is basically AV during the Thunder League. They're just having the worst time.
They're just having an absolute dog of a time.
Feels Batman. Oh well. But yeah, Madman leading, Nasty second, AV third, OP fourth, Aproxy fifth, SQ sixth, Lead seventh, Verve eighth. Verve, wow. They actually got a ton of kills, but also a ton of deaths. So yeah.
Well, that's exactly right. If you can't convert the kill, the wins into a if you can't convert the kills into a win, then what's the point of having the kills in the first place, I suppose.
Yeah. So Major actually told me just now that they have people from 13 different countries. That is insane.
Oh, wow.
That is wild.
Of course, Madman could actually form two teams for this match. They've chosen to form the single. Yeah, they have enough teams. They have, I think they have like...
They have 19 players.
Squadron itself, yes. But I believe actively playing esports, I think there are about 11 or 12. And if they, recruited a couple of floating players, like Ariello and things like that, then they could actually scrape together two teams.
Yeah, they have a lot of strong players left on their team. actually, Biggin just joined Madman, which is interesting.
Oh, imagine my boy Biggie. I just realized what I said.
Oh, yeah. Back for Mercy is actually on Nasty's team, so that's funny. Oh. But yeah, they have some strong players. So, it's an interesting tournament. It really is. I like it.
Well, we're going to be live the same time tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But I guess that's it for now.
Yeah. I'll probably stream. I don't want to stream on my own channel now because it's quite late. And you're probably going to take a nap, aren't you?
Oh, it's almost 7 in the morning. I'll probably put a couple of pies in the oven.
Crap.
Have some brekkie and then go to bed. Obviously, it's too late and I've got work in the evening. So
basically, Australians having a breakfast and then going to bed.
Not only that, but I'm having meat pies for
my God.
the only two things you can't have for breakfast, lunch and dinner. So...
yeah,
I think we've got it sorted.
So yeah, we'll be back tomorrow and for more matches, probably again, I suppose, if Zerba wants us, and more giveaways as well. So
stay tuned. We're going to be live the same time tomorrow, and hopefully we're going to have the same giveaways. We're going to have some pretty good matches, and hopefully we have the entertaining Mystic Man.
Always.
What more could you ask for?
Oh yes, hell yeah, bro. Yeah, it's gonna be fun. It's exciting to play to stream on this channel, and luckily I didn't botch it up.
So far no one's botched it up. We haven't had any major hiccups apart from a PC crashing, just magic.
But what can you do about that, really?
Yeah,
so yeah, we'll be back tomorrow.
Anyway,
and
exactly,
yeah.
Catch you next time.
Yeah, catch you next. Catch you next. Ugh, I can't speak. Spit, please. End it for me.
Take care.
See you, boys.
I'll catch you next time.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Right. See you, boys.